My pleasure at IPCA to welcome you all for today's webinar on ECG Update 2020, a Kauai Heart Rhythm Initiative. Yeah, it is in the series we are doing this webinar on ECG Update, and today it is third, right? And this is under the dynamic leadership of Dr. Lawrence Jesuraj, sir. This webinar on ECG Update has become very popular all across the country, and today we have two eminent faculties as a speaker. First, Dr. B.R.G. Kannan, sir. Dr. B.R.G. Kannan, sir, has done a fellowship in pediatric cardiology. He is a consultant pediatric and interventional cardiologist at Vadamalan Hospital, Madurai. Sir has authored numerous national and international publications in accredited journals. He is awarded Best Challenging Case Award at Transcatheter Therapeutics, that is TCT 2010 at Washington. Sir is a life member of Cardiological Society of India, Pediatric Cardiac Society of India, and Indian Association of Pediatrics. Sir is a principal investigator in pediatric eplerenone development study. He is a regular speaker at national and state level conferences. Sir also has authored numerous national and international publications in accredited journals. And sir will be speaking on a topic, interpretation of pediatric ECG basics. Welcome to Kannan, sir. Then we have Dr. John Roshan Jacob, sir, with us. Sir has done a fellowship in adult electrophysiology and pediatric electrophysiology. Sir is a professor at Department of Cardiology at CMC Vellore. A.V. Gandhi Award and Gold Medal for Excellence in Cardiology, sir, has received. He is a regular speaker at national as well as state level conferences. And sir has also authored many national and international publications in many accredited journals. And sir will be speaking on topic Approach to Arrhythmias in Children. This program is conducted under dynamic leadership of Dr. Lawrence Jesuraj, sir. As all of you know, sir has done a fellowship in electrophysiology from Care Hospitals, Hyderabad under Dr. Sri Narasimhan, sir. Sir has an advanced CRT training, Niguard General Hospital, Milan, Italy, then certified cardiac device specialization. Sir has also done a certificate in electrophysiology specialist from USA. Observations in complex arrhythmias, ablation, veterans in General Hospitals, Taiwan, and St. Luke's Medical Center in US. Sir is a young has got a young investigator award in APHRS 2021 in Taiwan for mitochondrial mutation in LQTS. As all of you know, Dr. Lawrence, sir, is a consultant cardiologist and electrophysiologist at Division of Cardiac Pacing and Electrophysiology at KMCH Heart Institute, Kauai Medical Center and Hospital at Coimbatore. And sir will be speaking on the topic, Management of Cardiac Arrhythmia in Children. So over to Lawrence, sir. Lawrence, sir, please.
Hello, hi. Thank you all. I welcome Dr. Kannan sir and John Roshan sir for accepting the this big responsibility of doing a webinar on Sunday. Wasting no time, I'm just asked Dr. Kannan sir to start his presentation. Welcome, sir. All these presentations will go consecutively. After that, we'll take questions, sir. You can start, sir. Thank you. Morning.
Thank you. So are you seeing my slide? Somebody can share my screen. So are you able to see the slides?
Yes, sir. No. Yes.
Yeah. Okay. So very good morning, everyone. I do understand that there are a lot of pediatricians, pediatric cardiologists, and other our cardiology colleagues have logged in, and my talk is going to be in general. Once again, thank you very much, Dr. Lawrence and his team, for arranging this meeting. This is going to be a very, really useful meeting. Now, what is the role of ECG in general? Throughout the world, one second, my slides are not moving.
Just click and move.
Yeah, okay. See, throughout the world, the commonest indication for doing ECG is ischemic heart disease. Arrhythmias comes next, then comes the structural heart disease. So now I am going to deal with the so-called use of ECG in pediatric structural heart diseases. So how can you go about it? See, when we read an ECG, never read the ECG in isolation. always have a clinical background when analyzing an ECG. We should understand that for structural lesions, ECG has poor sensitivity and specificity. For example, a large VST with not much LV forces, that is, a patient can have a large VST, but ECG may not show tall QRS complexes. On the other hand, there could be large QRS in a patient with small VST or even in a normal heart. So that's the problem with the ECG in structural heart disease. Anyway, let us go through how we can use this ECG effectively. When we record the ECG in a child, the limb leads are placed more proximally to reduce the motion artifacts. A older child will be cooperative, allowing us to take the ECG, but an younger child or infant or neonate may not allow us to take a proper ECG. So we can place the limb leads more proximally so that we get an ECG without any artifacts. The usual 12 lead ECG is not enough. We should have an additional V3R or V4R. Usually the standard gain 10 millimeters per millivolt is used, but we may need to halve it if the voltages are very high. So now let us come to the normal so-called age-related changes. There are various tables for various measurements for all ages. Is there any practical utility of the table? No, the answer is no. So what I should know about the so-called age-related changes? A newborn has right axis deviation and RV dominance. This dominant R in V3R or V1 can persist just up to 6 months or can remain so up to 8 years. See the wide range. That means by 6 months that our dominant R in V1 can disappear or it can persist up to 8 years. In the majority, the R by S in V1 becomes less than 1/4 years. So the T wave in V3R or V1 is inverted by 5 to 6 days. That is on day 1, day 2, the T will be positive. But by 5 to 6 days, T becomes inverted in V1. And it should not become positive before 6 to 7 years. That means in the interim period, it remains inverted or negative. So after 1 week of life, if the T wave is upright, it signifies that there is right ventricle hypertrophy, even if you don't have an voltage criteria. These are all normal age-related changes. Okay. The T inversion can persist even into adolescence, what we call as juvenile persistence of T inversion. This variation also we should remember. A 16, 17-year-old boy can commit chest pain and you can find T inversion from V1 to V3. It doesn't mean abnormal. That is just the persistence of T inversion up to into the juvenile period. See, I commonly see pediatricians or pediatric cardiologists commonly finding difficulty to identify the axis. See, what is axis? It's the general or mean vector of the electrical impulses that they travel through the heart. It's the sum total of all electrical currents generated by the ventricular or atrial myocardium during depolarization. It's just a definition. I'm going to simplify how to kind of look at the axis. See, select lead 1 and AVF. Nothing else is needed. Just select lead 1 and AVF because these are the leads that are electrically perpendicular to each other. Calculate the net QRS voltage. For example, if R is taller than S, then the net voltage is positive. Like here, the R is taller than S. If S is taller than R, then the net voltage is negative. See, here is negative. Here we call it just isoelectric. Okay. Just let us remember this. When I say QRS is positive, that means there is more positive R wave than the negative S wave. When I say QRS is negative, that means there is smaller R wave and a larger S wave. Now with this, what is normal? Normally, both in lead 1 and AVF, it is predominantly positive. So the axis is here, the left lower quadrant. It's a normal axis. Suppose if the QRS is negative in lead 1, but positive in AVF, the axis will fall here. So it is right axis deviation. So lead 1 negative, AVF positive is right axis deviation. And if lead 1 is positive, AVF is negative. AVF is negative, lead 1 is positive. The axis falls here. So it's left axis deviation. And if both are negative, this is the no man's land. So it's very simple. So take just lead 1 and AVF. If both are positive, it is normal axis. If lead 1 is positive, AVF is negative, it is left axis. Just imagine that you are holding a ribbon-like ECG. In the ribbon-like single lead ECG, you have 1, 2, 3, AVR, AVL, AVF, right? So AVF is the last lead. Lead 1 is the first lead. The lead 1 is in the left hand. AVF is in the right hand. If both are positive, it is normal. Now in the second example, lead one is positive. That is my left hand is up. My right hand is down. So lead one is positive, AVF is negative, it's left axis deviation. Suppose my left hand is negative, that is lead one is negative, AVF is positive, it is right axis deviation. So it's very simple to remember. Remember left hand lead one, right hand AVF. If both are positive, it's normal. If one is negative and one is positive, whichever is positive, it is that axis. My left hand is positive, it is left axis. My right hand is positive, it is right axis. If both are negative, it is northwest axis. Now, this has some importance in analyzing our structural disease also, in addition to whatever the role in arrhythmias. This is the normal newborn. Okay, normal newborn, what are things we see? We see a right axis deviation, see that AVF is positive, and we see RV dominance. This is the usual normal ECG of a normal newborn. In a 3-year-old child, the right axis deviation is almost getting to near normalcy now here. But still you can see some kind of RV dominance, okay? Now in a 5-year-old child, it's almost like an adult ECG. There is normal progression and very small R wave. The small R wave is going to further come down with time. So this is the progression of ECG changes in children. One need not remember more than this. One need not remember so many numbers in so many tables. Okay, this is enough for us to, for all practical purposes. So what is the importance of Q in limb leads? See, normally you'll have small Q wave in limb leads if you have observed. The Q waves are normally seen in leads 2-3 AVF in children. Please remember, I'm not talking about adults. In children, normally the Q waves are seen in lead 2-3 AVF. This is because of the clockwise loop of the initial QRS vector. We need not go into the theory, you can read it up. Okay. Most of the congenital diseases also have the so-called clockwise loop. So whenever I say the clockwise loop, what I mean is there is a small Q wave in 2-3 AVF. These lesions also will have right axis deviation of the QRS. See the ECG? Now I've just magnified the original, the first normal ECG. See the small QRS, see the small Q in lead 2, lead 3 AVF. This is normal. Unlike in adults, in children, they have small Q in 2-3 AVF. We call this as clockwise loop. Okay. Now, what about this one? 2-3 AVF, you don't see Q wave, but 1 and AVL, there are Q waves. So this is called as counterclockwise loop of the initial QRS. Okay. So just remember, don't go into the further mechanism. If you have Q waves in 2-3 AVF, that is normally in a newborn, it is because of the clockwise loop of the initial QRS. If you have lead 1 and AVL showing Q waves, it is counterclockwise loop. So what are the other normal variations? Early repolarization is very common. This topic many times we have discussed. So up to 1 to 4 millimeter ST elevation can be seen. T waves are generally very tall. The ST elevation is generally concave upwards. There can be at times, there can be a notch at the J point. And as you can see the ECG, at times if this ECG is given to an adult physician, the first thing that will come into the mind is the or ongoing or progressing acute myocardial infarction. But this kind of ECG can be commonly seen in children. See the next ECG, furthermore worrying. This ECG definitely says it's going to have MI, but actually this is a normal ECG. So we should remember that this kind of varying early repolarization are common in children, and we should have this in mind. The ST segment elevation with the terminal T inversion, as I showed in the previous ECG, also can be seen in normal children. QT interval can be shorter than usual. So this is normal arrhythmia seen in children, that is sinus arrhythmia. It's the commonest cause of irregular heart rate. It slows in expiration and speeds up in inspiration. Now, this is a 3-year-old boy referred for irregular heart rate. Leave alone other things. Just see the so much of RR variation. So much of RR variation. And when you see the pulse, it will be highly irregular. You tend to diagnose atrial fibrillation. But actually, it's not atrial fibrillation. It's only extreme form of sinus arrhythmia. So in sinus arrhythmia, the PP interval will vary. Correspondingly, RR interval varies. However, the PR interval is constant. Okay, see that here. PR interval is constant, but the ECG has so many variation. Now, how to know whether it's normal or abnormal? Very simple. You make the patient or make the child to exercise. Ask him to sit up for 5-10 times and then take the ECG. There'll be some tachycardia. With tachycardia, this vagal response will be aborted. There'll be tachycardia, but the rhythm will become very regular. So this is sinus arrhythmia is a normal finding in children. So QT interval also varies. We have to just have it in mind. So these are the other benign findings, atrial ventricular extrasystole. These are also abolished by exercise. So after going into some kind of normal variation, I'm going into more important things. How we are going to use the ECG for our pediatric cardiology? This is a very famous question by me put to everyone. Is this a sinus rhythm? The moment anybody sees this ECG, they'll say, yes, it's sinus rhythm. Why? Because there's P before ESQRS. No, it is not the answer. Yes, there is P before ESQRS. Let us go to the thing. See, in sinus rhythm, P precedes majority of QRS, need not be all QRS. Suppose somebody has 2:1 block, somebody has 3:2 conduction. That means one P will not be conducted. That means that is still sinus rhythm. Okay. And then somebody will say that PR interval is constant. That's why it is sinus rhythm. No, in Wenckebach phenomena, PR interval is not constant. Now, there is a P here prior to ESQRS. How do you know that this P is coming from sinus node? That means P axis has to be normal. As we discussed in the previous slide, we discussed about how to calculate the QRS axis. Now let us see the P axis. What is the P here? P is positive here in AVF. What's the P here in lead one? It's also positive. That means the P axis is normal. P is coming from right shoulder to the left lower limb. The P axis from the right shoulder from the left lower limb, which is the normal axis of a sinus P wave. If this is there, then you can call this a sinus rhythm. Of course, an occasional ectopic focus coming near the crista terminalis, near the sinus node, can have the same normal P axis, but let's forget that. Normally, when there is a sinus beat, which is occurring from the sinus node, you should have a normal P axis. That is, P should be normal in lead one, upright in lead one, and P should be upright in AVF. P can be anything in lead two or other leads. Let us forget that. Just remember one and AVF. Both should be upright. It is sinus rhythm. So, P precedes majority of QRS, need not be all QRS. P is related to QRS, but PR need not be constant. But P axis has to be normal to call this a sinus rhythm. See that P axis is normal. P is positive here, P is positive here. Now what about this one? The here also there is P prior to all QRS, but this is not sinus rhythm. Here P is inverted in AVF. P is positive in lead one. So you will immediately say that this is not sinus rhythm. Okay. There is a regular PQRS, PQRS, PQRS. There is no denial of the fact, but it is not a sinus rhythm. If you carefully observe, there is inverted P in 2-3 AVF. That means the source of this P is from lower part of the atrium, near the coronary sinus. What we call this as a low atrial rhythm or the coronary sinus rhythm. Okay. Now, is this atrial situs normal? Somebody says, give this ECG and ask you to identify situs, whether it is situs solitus or situs inversus. You might wonder how ECG can tell situs. Whenever we tell about situs of the heart, please remember we are referring only to the atria. We are not referring to the ventricles. Ventricles do not have situs. Whenever we say refer to situs, we are referring to atria. And if right atrium is on the right side and left atrium is on the right, left side, then we should have the same finding. That is, P should be positive in lead one, P should be positive in AVF. If these two are positive, that means right atrium is on the right side. That means it is situs solitus. Got the point? So when P axis is normal, it means sinus node, SA node is in the usual position. RA is on the right side, so it is situs solitus. So it's an excellent way of determining the situs solitus by the ECG. Now take this example. Now see, AVF is positive, but lead one is negative. Lead one is negative, AVF is positive. That means now the axis of the P wave is from the left shoulder to the right lower limb. AVF is positive, lead one is negative, so it's right axis deviation. The axis of the P wave is from the left shoulder to the right lower limb. Okay, so what is happening? It may be an ectopic rhythm arising from the left atrium, isn't it? There can be a constant source firing the left atrium and causing the rhythm. Or the RA could be situated in the left side. Okay. So when you have an inverted P in lead one, positive P in AVF, either the LA is the source of this rhythm or the RA could be situated on the left side. So this can be taken as an evidence to call this that the patient could be having situs inversus. Got the point? So if P axis is normal, it's situs solitus. If P axis is rightward, it is situs inversus. Well, let's come to the chest lead. What is happening in the chest lead? There are some T inversions. Let us forget about that. Look at the QRS. The QRS is R is V1, V2, reasonable R is there. V3 has become smaller, V4 very small, V5 is there is no R at all. Why there is no R at all? See, normally there's a progressive increase in the height of R from V1 to V6, isn't it? The V1 to V6, the heart keeps on progressing, the R keeps on increasing. This is because of the ventricular mass on the left side, because of the levocardia. Now suppose that particular child is not having the ventricular mass on the left side, then there won't be any progression of the QRS. Okay, so if this is absent, if the normal progression of the R height is absent, it might mean that the ventricular mass is not in the left side. That means when you have this finding, this could mean either mesocardia or dextrocardia. So got the point? So let us just go through this ECG again. You can see that inverted P in lead one, positive P in AVM, so it is situs inversus. There is no progression of the R wave, so it is situs inversus dextrocardia. Okay, the same patient, when you put the lead on the right side, what is happening? You can see the progression of the R wave because there is more heart on the right side, so there is progression of the R wave. So situs identification, that means situs solitus means normal P axis, situs inversus means right axis deviation of P wave. In levocardia, you have normal progression of QRS from V1 to V6, and in dextrocardia, there is non-progression of QRS. This is very useful for us to kind of based on ECG to see the location of the atria and the ventricles. Now, all newborns would have right ventricle hypertrophy. Then how do we diagnose that it is a pathological hypertrophy of a diseased heart? This is a common question to come on to mind, isn't it? So the RVH is pathological if there is extreme right axis, if there is upright T in V1, if there is monophasic R in V1, and RV strain pattern is there. Okay. If these things are there, then the RVH, whatever is we are recording the ECG, is probably pathological. So this child had a 4-day-old child with cyanosis, and you can see there is right axis deviation, and see monophasic R in V1. Actually, this child had primary pulmonary hypertension. Just to give an example of how to diagnose an abnormal R in V1. Okay. Now, do we have any diagnostic ECGs? Okay. So initially I said how to interpret the ECG basically, and I told you the usage of ECG in diagnosing the sinus rhythm, and hence its usefulness in identifying situs and levocardia, dextrocardia. Now, do we have any diagnostic ECGs in pediatric cardiology? Very, very few. I'm going to tell them first before going to the others. Now, take this ECG first. A 50-day-old child, cyanosed, single second sound, and there is ejection murmur at the pulmonary area. Now, let us come to the QRS axis. Normally, what I expect is a right axis deviation. It is left axis deviation, so it's abnormal. Okay. Now, I am seeing a prone and PM 2-3 AVF, suggestive of right atrial enlargement. Okay. Second positive finding. What I told earlier, normally QVFs are seen in 2-3 AVF. Here, QVFs are seen in 1 and AVL. That means there is counterclockwise loop. And in addition, in V1 and V2, V3, there is no R at all. That means there is no RV dominance at all. Totally RV has regressed. So if you combine all these things, absence of right ventricular forces, left axis deviation, counterclockwise loop. If these three things are there, it's very, very specific for the diagnosis called tricuspid atresia. Okay, please have it in mind. This is a very specific finding. So when do we say it's counterclockwise loop? There is QV in 1 and AVL. This counterclockwise loop is seen in tricuspid atresia, AV canal defect, inlet DVSD, some forms of DORV, in some peripheral PS of congenital rubella syndrome. I think you can forget about the last two. You can just maybe have it in the corner of your mind. But these two things you should remember, tricuspid atresia, AV canal defect, and inlet VSDs. And most of the time, whenever you have counterclockwise loop, you will also have left axis deviation of the QRS. Now let us go to another example. Here again, there is left axis deviation. Here again, you have counterclockwise loop. QVFs are seen in 1 and AVL. But you see both RV and LV dominance. Previous case, there was no RV dominance. Here's both RV and LV dominance. 6 weeks old child with mild distress. That means this child is having distress. There is feature of biventricular hypertrophy, meaning thereby there could be some post-tricuspid shunt. When clinically there is some post-tricuspid shunt, with that, if there is this counterclockwise loop and left axis deviation, it's very specific for the diagnosis of complete AV canal defect. You know, this cannot be a simple VSD, this cannot be a simple PDA, this cannot be a simple AP window. Because of the left axis deviation and counterclockwise loop, it's more in favor of complete AV canal defect. Now, what about this ECG? This ECG also showing left axis deviation. There are QVFs in 1 and AVL, but there is no biventricular features. Actually, the RV features are not there. So if you ask me, can this be tricuspid atresia? Yes, probably tricuspid atresia is very much possible. But in tricuspid atresia, I expected that there'll be a prominent P wave here, which is not there. Absence of prominent P wave, in a ECG, which is otherwise looking like a trigeminal atresia, could mean that it's an unbalanced AV canal defect. Okay, I hope you understand the background, whatever the technicality, whatever I am saying. Not to memorize the facts, just understand what is happening. ECG is just expressing what is inside the heart. Okay, so this is a child of known case of large VST. So I already given it as a case of large VST. In large VST, what we expect, the usual clockwise loop of 2-3 AVF. This we expect the usual QAVs in 2-3 AVF. But here what we have seen, small QAV in 1N AVF. So in a case with large VST, if you see a small QAV in 1N AVF suggests you have counterclockwise loop, you should seriously suspect there is inlet extension of the perimembranous VST or muscular VST or whatever you are talking about. So if you have not done that, after seeing ECG, you please go back and then look at the echo again. You might find that there could be some inlet extension. So this is the usefulness of finding QAVs in 1N AVL. So these are these changes, whatever I have said, are very specific. Okay. So other lesion specific changes, like if there is QAV in V1, normally you don't have QAV in V1, right? If there is QAV in V1, but absence of QAV in V5, V6, it suggests you have corrected transfusion of great arteries. Though I have mentioned this, even in transfusion of great arteries, I am not getting such a kind of classical ECG changes. In an ECG, if you find AV blocks, it suggests you have endocardial perfusion defect or corrected transfusion of great arteries. See, this is the ECG of corrected transfusion of great arteries. There's a QAV in V1, V2, but there are no QAVs in V5, V6. So let us come to the ECG more common conditions. Let us initially take this tetralogy of Fallot atrial septal defect. So a 2-month-old child, classical signs of tetralogy of Fallot. If somebody asks you, what is the ECG finding in tetralogy of Fallot? What you should say, it is right axis deviation, right ventricular hypertrophy, and counterclockwise loop. Clockwise loop, that's all, okay. So what is the ECG finding of tetralogy of Fallot? Right axis deviation, right ventricular hypertrophy, and clockwise loop. Now, there is no ECG finding that is very specific for a classical TOF. This we have to remember. Because in the first 6 months, there will be anyway right ventricular hypertrophy and right axis deviation for all children, isn't it? And there will also be a clockwise loop. So this finding of normal finding, which is a right axis deviation and right ventricular hypertrophy, is also the finding in TOIF. And hence, there is no typical ECG finding for TOIF. In addition, most of the serious heart diseases, they also have right ventricular hypertrophy and right axis deviation. Say transfusion of great arteries and say truncus arteriosus. Not only that, all TOF-like situations, they also have right axis deviation and right ventricular hypertrophy. Like DVRVVSTPS, corrected TGA-PS, single ventricle PS, TGVSTPS, ECD-PS, all will have this, except this ECD with PS, all will have right axis deviation and right ventricular hypertrophy. So as a corollary, in a case with suspected tetralogy of Fallot, if there is no counterclockwise loop, no RVH or no right axis deviation, that means we are dealing with a more complex congenital heart disease than a simple tetralogy of Fallot. Let us go further. This is a classical ECG of tetralogy of Fallot. See, there is right axis deviation. There are QAVs in 2-3 AVF, clockwise loop. There is a sudden transition from V1 to V2. Somebody might suggest that this is a very classical finding of TOIF, which is not, because see the next ECG, this is also a TOF patient. Is there a sudden transition? So the sudden transition of QRS or the RVF from V1 to V2 is neither specific for TOF nor sensitive for TOF. If the finding is there, it's well and good. If the finding is not there, but still it okay. But that you should remember that commonly in the exam, this is what the examiner is asking and this is what it should answer. But practically, this is not very true. This finding is seen, but this is neither specific nor sensitive for tetralogy of Fallot. Is there any other utility of ECG in tetralogy of Fallot? See this case, a one-year-old child with tetralogy of Fallot, severe cyanosis. He has all the findings, right axis deviation, clockwise loop, 2-3 AVF showing QAVs, and RV dominance is there. But what about V5, V6 RV? They are very, very small. What does this tells to us? You know, in tetralogy of Fallot, the severity depends on the amount of pulmonary blood flow. If more the pulmonary blood flow, less severe is the situation. Less is the pulmonary blood flow, more severe is the situation. If the pulmonary blood flow is good, then all the pulmonary blood flow will come to the LA and LV. So if you have a good LV forces in V5, V6, that might indicate good pulmonary blood flow and hence a relatively milder form of tetralogy of Fallot. Whereas if you have very poor LV forces and this, as in this condition, if you have very poor LV forces, that might mean the pulmonary blood flow is very much restricted and hence this child is a very sick case of tetralogy of Fallot. So that is the utility of other additional utility of ECG in tetralogy of Fallot. So when a patient is clinically tough, and if there is right axis deviation, right ventricle hypertrophy, and V1 to sudden transition, most probably we are dealing with a classical simple TAF. If there is left axis deviation and counterclockwise loop, where clinically you have diagnosed TAF, you are dealing with endocardial coercion defect or tricuspid atresia as the underlying lesion. If there are AV blocks, think about endocardial coercion defect or corrected transversion of great artery as the underlying lesion. And if there is extreme axis, biventricular features or LV dominance, then that's a complex pathology. Don't try to guess the underlying lesion based on the ECG. So this should be the interpretation. What about double outlet right ventricle? So we should remember that double outlet right ventricle is a finding than a diagnosis. Because a DOIR can be a simple VSD, it can be TAF, it can be TGA, or it can be a single ventricle. That's what we call as complex DOIR. So when you write in your diagnosis DORV, if you simply write one line as after the echo as DORV, it means nothing. So DORV means TAF-like DORV or TGA-like DORV or complex DORV or DORV in bracket, you should write simple VSD-like DORV. So all DORVs come into one of the four. Because DORV has so many expressions, we cannot have a single finding as finding of DORV. So there is no specific finding of DORV in ECG. But I do see examiners asking for what is the ECG finding of DORV. They do say something. But in my understanding, there cannot be a single ECG finding for DORV. What about single ventricle? Most of the time, there are two ventricles. There could be a large functional right ventricle, like in the case of mitral atresia, or there could be a large functional left ventricle, like in the case of tricuspid atresia. The underlying pathology could be double indent left ventricle, endocardial coercion defect, corrected transversion, etc. And again, there is no specific finding for single ventricle in ECG. So somebody may say monophasic R or monophasic S in V1 to V6. Yes, that may suggest. But anyway, we cannot have one single ECG finding for single ventricle. So just see, take this child, this 4-day-old child with cyanosis and shock. The axis in the no man's land. It's extreme right axis. Why do you say it's extreme right axis? See that there's a tall QRS in lead 3. So it is extreme right axis. Extreme right axis and extreme RV dominance, this child. This child actually had hypoplastic left heart syndrome. I won't say that this is classical of hypoplastic left heart syndrome, but you can imagine this is really the finding in a case with hypoplastic left heart syndrome because left heart is not developed. Let us come to the simple ostium secondum ASD. What are the findings in ostium secondum ASD? There is normal QRS axis. There will be clockwise loop and the so-called RS RS pattern in V1. Very classical, everybody aware of that. This is the classical finding of ostium secondum ASD. 4-year-old child, clinically ASD, more than 2:1 shunt. You are diagnosed clinically ASD. He has been referred to you for device closure. Okay. And you have taken the ECG. This is the ECG. What is abnormal of this ECG as compared to the previous ECG? Here there's a typical RS RS pattern is there. But what happens here? There's a left axis deviation. Lead 1 is positive, AVF is negative. And you have Q waves in 1 and AVL. When you have Q waves in 1 and AVL left axis deviation, what did they say? It suggests you have a form of endocardial coercion defect. So clinically, you have diagnosed ASD, and ECG suggests you have endocardial coercion defect. That means it suggests you have ostium primum ASD. So after ECG itself, you will be able to tell the patient that most probably I will not be able to close this by device. I should be sitting for surgery because I am expecting a ostium primum defect, which is not going to be amenable for device closure. Okay, this is another example of ostium primum AST. Again, left axis deviation and RS-RS pattern. What about this ECG? A 3-year-old child with signs of ASD. Here you see some kind of flattening of P wave or very small positive P wave in lead 1, a negative P wave in AVF. So here there's a change in the axis of the P wave. Which AST will have a different axis of P wave? You can imagine that it's a sinus venous ASD because sinus node is there. Sometimes sinus node dysfunction is associated with sinus venous ASD. They can have this much of ECG. But even in sinus venous ASD, P axis is normal. If you find an abnormal PA axis, that might tell you that it could be a sinus venosus ASD. Now, this is a 1-year-old child with ejection murmur. The echo shows 12 millimeter ASD. 12 millimeter ASD is a very large ASD for a 1-year-old child. You can see that there is right axis deviation and there is RV hypertrophy features. Rather, non-regression of the RV is still persisting. This child, we need to subject the child for surgery very early. This is not the usual RS RS pattern you will see. Here you see actually a RV strain pattern. So this is small 5% children, 5% of the children who will need surgery for ASD before 1 year. But on the other hand, you take this 32-year-old gentleman who is a known case of ASD. He has right axis deviation. He has tall R waves. He has a QR pattern and RV strain pattern. So if this kind of ECG is there, most probably he is going to be inoperable. Even if he has clinically normal, the clinically there is no desaturation, even if your echo is showing ASD shunting only left to right, this kind of ECG will tell us, or most probably tells us, that he is probably has gone towards inoperability. So how do we read ECG in ASD? The QRS is normal or rightward in V1. There is RS-RS in V1. If P axis is leftward, suspect sinus venosus ASD. But remember that most of the sinus venosus defects have normal P axis. If there is left axis deviation of the QRS, again suspect ostium primum ASD. As the PA progresses, the RS RS changes gradually to monophasic R and then to QR pattern. Like here, it's almost a QR pattern. If you have a QR pattern, that means the RV pressure is much higher than the LV pressure. Okay, so this is how we use this is the utility of ECG in ASD. This is a second post-operative day in a child who operated for ASD. You can see a ST elevation in multiple, almost all leads. You have ST elevation in all leads with concavity upwards and PR depression in all the leads. See the PR depression? So this is a very classical feature of pericarditis, which we see very common in the post-operative period. This is nothing to worry. As the inflamed operation related inflammation goes up, this will go up. So it's a 6-month-old child, more than 2:1 post-striker's position. I have simply given it as post-striker's position. So very classical ECG of biventricular hypertrophy, what we call as a KW phenomena. This is a feature of a large VST. Now, another example of a large VST, which we have commonly seen, so there is nothing to discuss. See here, come back again here. There is a right axis deviation. See the QVS in 2-3 AVF? They all will have the usual clockwise loop. Okay. Now, the same biventricular hypertrophy features, but see there is a QVF in 1 and AVF, counterclockwise loop. So as I told you earlier, either we are dealing with an inlet VST here, or whatever may be the VST that's going to have a significant inlet extension. Okay. So that's the interpretation of this ECG. Okay. Now, this is a 10-year-old child, asymptomatic, echo shows large VST. Now here, it's a right axis deviation. RV strain, there is no LV forces. So we know that the child is, again, as I gave an example of ASD, this is a child which has gone towards eastern ingratiation. These are the features where ECGY suggests that inoperability is probably there. So what about ECG in post-striker's positions? The QRS axis is rightward or normal. If it is towards left, think about endocardial cushion defect or inlet extension of VST. In older children, if there is right axis deviation with RV strain pattern, it may suggest development of pulmonary vascular disease. So we have to be very careful. LV forces correlate very well with the degree of pulmonary blood flow. Hence, those with increased pulmonary vascular disease or Frank-Ishimnig syndrome will not have a tall LV. It will become normal LV. Okay. The tall LV becoming a QRS complexes, becoming normal QRS complexes, means that the pulmonary vascular disease has set in and patient is going towards Ishimnig syndrome. This is how we can utilize the ECG in the post-striker's positions. So this boy is an asymptomatic boy with incidental murmur. So what do we see here? Tall or in, say this 10-year-old boy, tall or in V1. So this child had ejection murmur, this child had pulmonary stenosis. So in pulmonary stenosis, what do we expect is the right ventricular hypertrophy. So what about this one? This is another patient, 12-year-old boy, known heart disease since early childhood, severe effort intolerance. Now what you see here, right axis deviation, some broadening of QRS and QR pattern in V1. As I said, if you have QR pattern in V1, that means suggests supra-systemic right ventricular pressures. Indeed, this child had a supraventricular right ventricular pressure. This child also had severe pulmonic stenosis. So ECG in pulmonic stenosis, the height of R in V1 and V3R correlates with the severe depth of pulmonary stenosis. There will be right ventricular hypertrophy and right axis deviation. The QRS is northwest. Just remember this. In a child whom you have diagnosed as pulmonary stenosis, the QRS is northwest. This is peculiarly seen in patients with Noonan syndrome. Okay. In aortic stenosis and coarctation of aorta in the newborn period, though it's a left-sided disease, they do not show LVH. Rather, they show only RVH. Because RV was the dominant ventricle in the newborn, in spite of having severe AS and severe coarctation of aorta, newborns will not show LVH in the ECG. In older children, adults, the degree of LVH correlates with the severity of these two lesions, AS or coarctation of aorta. So this is a 12-year-old child, mild cyanosis and dyspnea and exertion. This is very classical of what we call as Epstein's anomaly. Okay, you have very broad, bizarre QRS, RBV-like or whatever you call. Again, you have a very bizarre QRS. This is a suggestion of Epstein's anomaly. Again, I'm giving multiple examples of Epstein's anomaly. You can see the tall PFs. Most of the time, they also have this tall PF because of the very large enlargement of the right atrium. So I'm coming to the last part. I just quickly finished. Hope you got the idea of how to exactly place the ECG in patients with congenital heart disease. Role of ECG in cardiomyopathy. It's a 3-month-old child referred as dilated cardiomyopathy. But if you see here, there are tall QFs in one and AVL. There is ST depression, T inverse in the lateral leads. If this ECG is given in an adult, we generally diagnose this as either severe left ventricular hypertrophy or lateral wall ischemia. Okay. When a 3-month-old child, which cannot have this ECG, isn't it? A 3-month-old child should have a right axis deviation, should have RV dominance, but he has a feature suggestive of heart failure, echo showing LV dysfunction, patient is referred as dilated cardiomyopathy, but ECG is showing QFs in one and AVL features of lateral wall ischemia. It's very classic, we should never ever forget about this. At times what happens, this is a 6-year-old girl referred as moderate MR. It was only MR. There was some scarring of the papillary muscle. It was not suggestive of rheumatic heart disease. This is the ECG. It's the same finding. Same given one and AVL, kind of left axis deviation and a T inversion in the lateral leads. This cell also had anomalous origin of left coronary artery from the pulmonary artery, what we call as ALCAPA. So in the newborn period, any child with LV dysfunction, we have to rule out this ALCAPA. In an older child, if there is isolated mitral regurgitation, before diagnosing rheumatic heart disease, of course, other telltale evidence of rheumatic wall involvement, it's okay. Otherwise, one should have this possibility in the mind. So this is a 4-year-old boy with dilated cardiomyopathy. What you can see, there's a tachycardia and there's an inverted PVF prior to that. It's a long RP tachycardia. So how to deal with the long RP tachycardia? Subsequently, Dr. Jonathan is going to talk. But anyway, once you diagnose that there is a unusual tachycardia going on, once you treat the tachycardia, the cardiomyopathy will improve and they become near normal. So this is the equality. See, this is the same child's ECG after ablating the tachycardia. So in a child with dilated cardiomyopathy, we have treatable cardiomyopathy. These two important things. One is ALCAPA, second is tachycardiomyopathy. Both are very well diagnosed by ECG. Please remember that. So if you are sending away a patient with dilated cardiomyopathy without taking ECG, it's a very grave mistake. So this is a 3-month-old child referred as hypertrophic cardiomyopathy. Like this kind of extremely tall QRS complexes are seen in Pompe's disease. This is extremely rare. Pompe's disease is very rare. After coming to Madurai, I have not seen one. I have seen at least 2 cases when I was at Amrita. So this is a classical example of Pompe's disease. So ECG in cardiomyopathies. ALCAPA has to be ruled out in all cases of DCM and isolated mitral regurgitation. Even mild incident tachycardia can cause cardiomyopathy. Young infants with hypertrophic cardiomyopathy with LV dysfunction, please rule out Pompe's disease. Okay, so arrhythmias again is going to come back subsequently. So summarize my talk. ECG is very useful in identifying situs and cardiac position. It is diagnostic in certain conditions like tricuspid atresia, endocardial cushion defect. It aids in assessing the volume or pressure overload in shunts and other valvar lesions. It is useful in many non-cardiac conditions like hyperkalemia, hypocalcemia, which I have not discussed because it's a general topic, which anyway you all will be knowing. ALCAPA and tachycardiomyopathy should be ruled out in any case of dilated cardiomyopathy. Thank you for the patient listening. Thank you. Hello, can somebody reply? Hello.
Yes, sir.
Anand sir, thank you, sir.
Yeah.
Thank you. John Roshan sir, in line?
Yes, I'm here, Lauren.
Sir, you can start, sir. Thank you.
Hi, sir. Sure.
Thank you, sir.
So, thank you very much, Dr. Kannan sir, for giving that very nice introduction and the giving everybody a good feel about the ECG in the pediatric setup. It makes a huge difference, and you made my job very easy. I'll now move on to talking about the arrhythmias in the congenital heart disease. I'm just starting to share my slides. So if you can tell me whether you can see the slides. So is everybody able to see the slides?
Yeah, sir. Very well. You can start, sir.
Okay. So at the outset, I'm very grateful to my good friend, Dr. Lawrence, for inviting me to this, and to the IPCA team for making this possible. So I'm going to start talking about how to approach arrhythmias in children. And it's a pretty vast topic, and I'm going to highlight a few things which I feel need a little bit more discussion. So we'll briefly talk about the tachyarrhythmias. I'm not going to really speak about bradyarrhythmias this time because for want of time and not able to dwell on each thing properly enough. And I'm not going to dwell too much on ventricular tachycardias. I'm going to primarily be talking about supraventricular tachycardias, which are quite common in children. And I'll also talk briefly about the role of the esophageal EP study, which is something which is good to use in children, particularly in neonates. So supraventricular tachycardias, when you see in a child, you know, usually one in every 1,000 children can have a SVT. And it's by far the commonest tachyarrhythmia in children. So VT is not something that you see in children. When you see a child with a tachycardia, it's often an SVT. Even if you have a broad complex tachycardia, it usually is an SVT, which could be antidromic tachycardia. Of the supraventricular tachycardias that are seen in children, the mechanism responsible for it is reentry in the vast majority. And about 50% of children present with SVT in the first year of life. Among those who have SVT, 50% of them have it in the first year of life. And of these, AVRT is by far the most common arrhythmia. So when you look at SVT in children, the major differentials you're looking at are AVRT, AVNRT, atrial tachycardias, and atrial flutters. So these are the four things I'm going to speak about. And I have put them in the order in which you sort of tend to see them in pediatric population. So when you look at an arrhythmia, you broadly classify it as either AV nodal dependent or AV nodal independent. So if the arrhythmia circuit involves the AV node, it obviously depends on the AV node. And this means that if you block the AV node by either giving something like adenosine or doing a carotid sinus massage, then you could quite effectively terminate the arrhythmia. So AV nodal dependent arrhythmias are AVNRT and AVRT, and they respond to medications which can help block the AV node. AV nodal independent arrhythmias are arrhythmias which have nothing to do with AV node, and AV node is just a passive bystander. So an arrhythmia like an atrial tachycardia or an atrial flutter or an atrial fibrillation, where the atrium is basically the driver, the AV node is just passively going to conduct the impulses that come and hit it. And so the AV node really doesn't have any role in the arrhythmia per se. And hence, even if you block the AV node, the arrhythmia would still be continuing. So you may block conduction of an atrial tachycardia down to the ventricle, but your atria are still going to be going on in the atrial tachycardia rate. So they would be AV nodal independent arrhythmia. So typically, if you had an ECG of somebody having an atrial flutter or an atrial tachycardia and you gave them adenosine and blocked the AV node, you would then continue to see P waves going on at the fast rate, and your QRSs would be much slower because you have blocked AV nodal conduction. But you have not terminated the tachycardia. Your tachycardia is still continuing. And once the drug effect wears off, the AV nodal conduction will resume and your ventricular rate will become fast. There's another way in which arrhythmias are generally classified, and this sort of makes you find electrophysiologists usually using this jargon, and it only makes things a little confusing. But to sort of make it simple, they talk about tachycardias as either long RP tachycardias or short RP tachycardias. When do you say a long RP tachycardia and when do you say a short RP? You basically look at the RP interval and you look at the PR interval. So if the RP is less than your PR, it would be a short RP tachycardia. Whereas if your RP is longer than your PR, it would be a long RP tachycardia. So when you look at a short RP tachycardia, your AVRT, orthodromic AVRT, AVNRT, which is a typical form of slow fast AVNRT, they would generally come under short RP tachycardia. Whereas when you look at a long RP tachycardia, where actually your PR interval is quite short, that's something you usually see in atrial tachycardias or an AVRT where you have a slowly conducting axis 3 pathway or an atypical AVNRT like a fast slow AVNRT. So I'll come to each of these in a little bit detail to make it easy. So starting off talking about AVRT, this slide is basically trying to drive home the point that the younger the child is with an arrhythmia, the more likely it is going to be AVRT. So if you look at the incidence of AVRT, it's 85% in children less than 1 year, 82% in those 1 to 5 years, 56% in 5 to 10 years. So you can see that as the child's age increases and a child presents with an SVT, the odds of it being an AVRT start dropping. So much so to say that if you actually have an ECG of a 1-year-old sent to you with an SVT, the odds that it's an AVRT are very, very highly likely. Now, there's another very important point to remember is that, you know, you often have the parents of a child who's had a tachycardia, the parents are very anxious. You know, pediatric population, you always know that parents are very, very worried. And the parents will always ask you the question whether such a thing can happen again. The child came with an SVT and child probably went into failure, required admission, tachycardia terminated, all is well, you've started a child on medication and you're discharging the child. The parents will ask you, can this happen again? Now, the most important thing to remember is that if your initial presentation of an SVT happened after the child was 1 year of age, then the chance of it recurring is very, very high. SVTs that present less than 1 year of age as the first presentation, there's a good chance that over that 1 year, that accessory pathway regresses and the chance of you having the tachycardia thereafter becomes less. But when the SVT happens after 1 year of age, the first presentation of SVT happening after 1 year of age, the chance of it recurring is higher. We then move on to manifest and concealed pathways. Now, when you're looking at a manifest pathway and a concealed pathway, obviously manifest, the very English word manifest means it's obvious. It's declaring itself. So when you talk about somebody with a WPW syndrome, you're obviously referring to a pathway where there's pre-excitation. You're seeing evidence of pre-excitation. So you know that there's an axillary pathway that's declaring its presence there. And this may not be particularly apparent if you have a left-sided pathway. Now, when you have pre-excitation on an ECG, you know obviously that you have an axillary pathway that is capable of anti-grade conduction. Now, it's important to understand that these accessory pathways need not always be capable of conduction both ways. Sometimes you may have a pathway that can conduct only from top to down. Sometimes you may have a pathway that can conduct only from down to top. And sometimes you can have it capable of conduction both ways. But when you have an ECG showing you obvious pre-excitation, then you know for sure that you have a pathway that is capable of conducting anti-gradely. Now, an anti-gradely conducting pathway, which is on the left side, may not always present with a WPW. Now, I'll explain that in a short while, but it's important for you to know that of patients presenting with atrioventricular reentrant tachycardia, 55% of them have pre-excitation visible on the ECG. So look at this ECG and you can clearly make out that your PR interval is short. You have a negative in lead B1. So this obviously suggests that it's the arising current is traveling away from B1. So it's a right-sided accessory pathway. and it is negative in 3 and AVF, suggesting it's a posterior pathway. So it's a right posterior, and you're starting to see an R wave in V2. So it's a right posteroseptal accessory pathway. But the point I'm trying to make over here is that when you look at these QRSs here, you hardly have a PR interval. And you have this QRS looking pregnant over here that suggests the presence of an accessory pathway. Now, we were just talking about pre-excitation and manifest pre-excitation. Now, when you look at the patient who's got an accessory pathway, if you look at this entire region, which is, I would like to call it as the kingdom of the ventricle. You know, in the olden days, you had various kingdoms like the Chola kingdom and the Pandya kingdom, and each king had his respective territory. So this entire region is the kingdom of the ventricle. And this region is normally ruled by the AV node, because impulse comes down the AV node and activates the entire kingdom. Now, if somebody was to have an accessory pathway, there's a possibility for current to come down the normal way as well as down the accessory pathway. Now, if it's a left-sided accessory pathway, the current from the sinus node has to travel across the atrium and come down all the way here to reach this pathway, whereas the AV node is located more close to the sinus node, and hence current is going to reach the AV node much earlier than it was to reach this pathway. So though this pathway is capable of anti-grade conduction, it may not be manifest, because current has reached the AV node, crossed the AV node, and once it crosses the AV node, it travels down really fast to activate the entire ventricle, giving you your QRS. So the point I tried to make was that when you see a manifest pathway, when you see an ECG showing pre-excitation, you know that this pathway is capable of anti-grade conduction. But a patient may have a pathway capable of anti-grade conduction, but you may not see it on the ECG. And that usually happens with left-sided pathways. They're capable of anti-grade conduction, but they are not manifest, just because they are located very far away from the sinus node. And in this ongoing competition between the AV node and the pathway, current reaches the AV node and travels down to activate the ventricles much faster than it would reach the accessory pathway. So I was talking to you about this kingdom of the ventricle, and in a given patient, the ECG can change from time to time. For example, let's say you're listening to a boring talk like my talk at the moment, and when this talk gets boring, you obviously have increased vagal outflow, you start feeling sleepy. And when you have increased vagal outflow and feeling sleepy, the vagal outflow influences your AV node and slows down conduction of your AV node, which means current is going to travel down this way slower than usual, which gives a chance for the accessory pathway to take control over the entire ventricle. So the accessory pathway takes control of the entire ventricle, leading to greater pre-excitation that you can see on the ECG. So you have an ECG with a great deal of pre-excitation, and the same person, if you had to do his ECG later in the day when he was going around with his fiance or something like that, and he had a lot of adrenaline circulating inside him, then you would have the AV node conducting really slick and giving the pathway a stiff competition, leading to a relatively narrow QRS. So in a patient with a manifest pre-excitation, the ECG can vary from time to time based on the amount of activation of the AV node and the pathway. So is that clear with all of you? We'll now move on from that point to the location of the pathways. So pathways can be located around the tricuspid annulus and around the mitral annulus. And the location of the pathway has been defined based on the anatomical appearance of where the pathways can be located. So you can call pathways as being posteroseptal, or being mid-septal, antroseptal, anterior, right lateral, right posterior. So these are how pathways are generally located. And this is based on the left anterior oblique view, where you see the tricuspid annulus and the mitral annulus end fast. Now it's important for you to understand that though we say anterior and posterior, in the real human body, what is anterior is actually what is superior, and what's posterior is actually what is inferior. So a posteroseptal pathway is anatomically, actually, if you were to look at it, it would actually be inferior or infroseptal. So how do you decide from an ECG as to where a pathway is located? Now, there are a lot of algorithms which sort of some people are very smart. They can sort of mug up an algorithm, look at an ECG and read off from it as to where a pathway is located. I'm not capable of doing that. I generally sort of look at the ECG and try to use the vectors and figure out where the pathway is. And I find that a lot easier than trying to memorize an algorithm. So when you sort of look at that, when you're looking at an ECG, if you have a transition after V2, it's most likely a right-sided pathway. Because it basically means the current is traveling away from V1. So current is coming to the right side, V1 is a right-sided lead, current is traveling away from V1, and so it's a right-sided pathway. Same way, 2-3 AVF are inferior leads. So if you see negative in 2-3 AVF, current is traveling away from the inferior aspect, which is also the posterior aspect. So if you see prominent QSS in 2-3 AVF, you're talking about a posteriorly located pathway. So here on this ECG, you can see that you've got a negative in V1, current is traveling away from V1, so it's a right-sided pathway. From V1 to V2, it quickly changes to you starting to see an R wave here, so that sort of makes it probably septal. And when you look at 2-3 AVF, they're all positive, particularly in 2 and AVF. So it makes you think of a right-sided pathway, which is probably antroseptal in location. So moving on from there to the tachycardia ECG. So in somebody who's got an orthodromic AVRT, you generally see a short RP tachycardia. In other words, your RP interval is shorter than your PR interval. However, the RP interval is usually more than 70 milliseconds. In an AVNRT patient, the RP interval will be less than 70 milliseconds. And when you look at an ECG of a patient with an AVRT, I just told you an orthodromic AVRT will give you a narrow complex tachycardia. Your RP interval is going to be short. But once you have that much sorted out, you try to look at the P wave, and from the way appearance of the P wave, you try to figure out where the pathway is located. So when you're talking about orthodromic AVRT, the current is traveling down the AV node, activating the ventricle, then going up the accessory pathway to activate the atrium. So wherever the pathway lands in the atrium is from where the atrium is going to get activated. So let us say it's a left-sided pathway. When the current travels and up the pathway to activate the atrium, it'll activate the left atrium first. So when the left atrium gets activated first, current is going to travel from there to activate the rest of the atria. So the bulk of atrial activation is going to be happening from the left to the right side because your pathway landed on the left side, which means current is going to travel away from lead one. And on this ECG, as you can see, you have negative P waves in lead one. And a negative P wave in lead one means current is traveling away from lead one in the atria. And that suggests lead one being a left-sided lead. Obviously, the left atrium is activated first and current is traveling away from there. You know that you're dealing with a left-sided accessory pathway. And you again have a narrow complex tachycardia, and your RP interval is more than 70 milliseconds. Now, I'll come to the reason why that is more than 70 in a short while. But it's very, very important for me to stress this to you all, is the importance of getting a 12-lead ECG. So I know there are a lot of people who have just finished their MBBS or watching this talk, and a lot of other MD physicians are watching this talk. It's very, very important for you to get a 12-lead ECG because that gives a lot of valuable information. So don't take a single rhythm strip from the defib monitor and then say patient had tachycardia. SVTs are very, very unlikely to be hemodynamically unstable. In a child, the normal blood pressure is going to be 80 or 90 systolic. So don't record an 80 systolic, 90 systolic blood pressure and assume the child is crashing. Usually the nurse will be very anxious, and that anxiety of the nurse, like a referred pain, becomes a referred anxiety to the doctor. And the doctor immediately pushes in some adenosine or tries some keratin massage and terminates the arrhythmia. I would rather that you sort of get the ECG technicians down, get a 12-lead ECG recorded, and then terminate the arrhythmia. And even when you terminate the arrhythmia, make sure you're having a rhythm strip running of at least 3 or 4 channels running as you give adenosine, so that you can see how it terminates, whether it terminates as a P wave, terminates as a QRS, that gives you valuable information towards making your diagnosis. So when you have a 12 ECG over here, you see clearly that it's a long RP tachycardia. You see that your P waves are negative in 2-3 AVF. So you know that your atria are being activated from down to top. So it's in keeping with an orthodromic AVRT. Your RP being more than 70 milliseconds makes typical AVNRT unlikely. And you see negative P waves in lead one. So straight away, you know that you're dealing with a left-sided accessory pathway. Now, this is of great importance to the electrophysiologist, because when he has to talk to the patient, he has to tell the patient that the child has got a pathway on the left side. When I'm going to do my ablation, I have to go to the left side. I'll have to do a transseptal puncture. A transseptal puncture can have complications, and you will explain the potential complications of transseptal puncture and get consent for the same. So, you know, getting this ECG is of great importance in various ways, more ways than one. We now move on to re-entry. So I just told you earlier that the vast majority of arrhythmias in children are due to re-entry. And two of them, we just mentioned, one was AVRT and the other was AVNRT. So how does re-entry cause arrhythmias? Essentially, it has to do with two key terms. One is conduction velocity and the other is refractory period. So you should have two pathways which are connected to each other. So you have two ways for current to travel. Here's one way and here's the other way. And these two ways should be connected proximally and distally. They should have an area in between, which is electrically inert. And these two ways should have different conduction velocities and different refractory periods. So these are the prerequisites for you to have re-entry to happen. You should have two ways, and these two ways should differ in their conduction velocities and their refractory periods. And that is what is going to make the difference. So what usually happens is that when the person has got two ways for current to travel, like you have the AV node and an accessory pathway, every single impulse that comes travels down both. Now, when it travels down both, you obviously have part of the ventricle getting activated early, abolishing your PR interval flat isoelectric line, leading to the appearance of this pregnant QRS, where you have this sort of pre-excitation appearing. This pre-excitation is because part of the ventricle has got pre-excited, got excited earlier than usual. It was not meant to get activated early, but because of this pathway, it has got activated early. If this pathway was not here, this AV node would have activated and this area would have got activated pretty late. So because of that, your QRS is not narrow. Your QRS sort of become broad and you've got a pre-excited QRS. Now, when this person has a premature atrial beat happening, you have a PAC, which has happened earlier than usual. The normal P wave was looking like this, and the next P wave was supposed to happen somewhere around here, but you have a PAC happening over here now. Now, when this PAC happens, it knocks on both doors, take it down. But the accessory pathway has got a longer refractory period. So it conducts fast, but it has a longer refractory period. Remember, I told you for re-entry, you should have different conduction velocities. So this guy conducts slow, this guy conducts fast, but you should also have different refractory periods. This guy is long refractory period, this guy is short refractory period. So when the PAC comes, this guy cannot take that PAC down because he has a long refractory period. He's saying, I need some more time to recover my conduction. So this AV node takes the impulse down, and so the impulse travels down the AV node. Once it travels down the AV node, the QRS will look absolutely normal because every single part of the ventricle gets activated at the same instant. That is the beauty of God's creation, because current travels down the right bundle, travels down the left bundle, and these Purkinje fibers go to every single village inside the ventricular kingdom. So everybody's light turns on at the same time. And so if this fellow got activated, he gave a small QRS, this guy gave a small QRS, and all these QRS are superimposed on each other, and you are sitting from outside and looking at this heart on the ECG, and you end up seeing a thin, tall, handsome QRS. So this thin, tall, handsome QRS is the result of the activation of this entire ventricle down the AV node. Now, after this ventricle has got activated, the impulse now can travel back up because you've got this axillary pathway available, and he had a long refractory period. The impulse took a long time to come down with AV node, and that long time was enough for the impulse to now travel back up and activate the atrium. So you ended up having re-entry. The same impulse came down and re-entered by going up. So you have re-entry, orthodromic AVRP has happened. Impulse is traveling down AV node to the ventricle, then up accessory pathway, then atrium. It's important for you to understand that your tachycardia is going to be narrow QRS because you are activating the ventricles down the AV node. It's also important for you to understand that every single component of this is obligatory to the circuit. You need the atria, you need the AV node, you need the bundle of His, you need the bundled branches, you need the Purkinje fibers, you need the ventricle, you need the accessory pathway and the atria again. So for example, a patient is having orthodromic AVRT and somebody were to theoretically cut off the atria, tachycardia will terminate. Having orthodromic AVRT, somebody was to theoretically cut off the ventricle, tachycardia will terminate. Tachycardia is going on, you cut off the AV node, tachycardia will terminate. Every one of these things is absolutely essential for this tachycardia to occur. And all of them are placed in series for this tachycardia to happen. So you can understand that only after the ventricle is activated, can the atria get activated. It activates the ventricle, travels up the accessory pathway, then to the atria. So your P wave can happen only after the QRS. So your QRS happens and only after that will come your P wave. Your P wave will be negative because it's retrograde activation. So it will be negative in the 2-3 AVF leads. So you will now understand why this RP interval has to be more than 70 milliseconds. The reason it's more than 70 milliseconds is because it takes time. The atria cannot get activated at the same time as the ventricle. It can get activated only after the ventricle because they're all in a series circuit. So your ventricle gets activated, then your accessory pathway, and then your atrium gets activated. So we now, this is just a cartoon to explain the same point that I was just making. So you have this patient who's got an accessory pathway and this AV node. So impulse comes down both, activating both initially. That's why you have a pre-excitation on an ECG. But now there's a PAC that happens. When PAC happens, accessory pathway is saying, hey, I can't take you down. I have a long refractory period. So it goes down the AV node, but it's taking a long time to come down the AV node, by which time the accessory pathway has recovered conduction. And so it goes back up the accessory pathway, activating the atrium. Again, down the AV node, activating the ventricle, then goes up the accessory pathway to activate the atrium. And that's why you have a RP interval, which is short, but longer than 70 milliseconds. Though it's a short RP tachycardia, it will be longer than 70 milliseconds because this atrium can activate only after the ventricle. This entire thing is in series. And this cartoon describes a right-sided accessory pathway. So now the same thing can happen the other way around. If you had a tachycardia where the impulse went down the accessory pathway and then climbed up the AV node, that would be antidromic AVRT, and your QRS will end up looking broad because you're activating from here, the entire ventricle is getting activated abnormally. It is not getting activated down the AV node through these fibers such that every single village in the ventricle got current at the same time. When it gets activated antigradely down the axillary pathway, these villages will get current earlier and these villages will get current late. So you'll end up having a very broad QRS. So antidromic AVRT will result in a broad complex tachycardia, though it is still a supraventricular tachycardia. And the tachycardia essentially involves coming down the axillary pathway to the ventricles, then the bundle branches, AV node, atrium. So the same circuit going around in the opposite direction. Both these tachycardias involve the AV node. AV node is integral to the circuit, which means that if you block the AV node, you can terminate tachycardia. So they are all AV node dependent tachycardias. So this is again just showing you a broad complex tachycardia, which is actually an antidromic AVRT in a child. We now move on to the etiology of syncope in WPW syndrome. So you have a child on ECG showing pre-excitation, and the child's parents bring the child saying that the child had fainted in school one, then you will take that history seriously. Now, why is syncope a concern in WPW? We all know that when you look in the normal people, there is no accessory pathway. So every impulse has to come down the AV node. and the AV node has got a refractory period which will not allow every impulse to come down it. It will slow down. So if you bombard the AV node with 300 impulses, it will allow only 1 in 2 or 1 in 3 to go down. It will not allow every impulse to go down. So that helps you because your ventricles won't beat at a very fast rate. So though the atrial rate may be 300 due to an atrial flutter, or maybe 600 due to an atrial fibrillation, your ventricles will not go at 600 and 300. They will probably go at around 150 because your AV node will block those impulses. This is God-given mechanism to save us from death. But unfortunately, when somebody has got an accessory pathway, and you remember the accessory pathway can take impulses down, when the atria are going at a very rapid rate, there's a good chance that they will go down this accessory pathway, making the ventricles go at a very rapid rate. So this God-given protection has been bypassed, and which can lead to a lot of trouble. So what actually happens is, when you have somebody with that kind of situation, you have impulses sometimes coming down the accessory pathway, sometimes coming down the AV node, but the ventricles are getting activated very rapidly all the time, leading to very rapid ventricular rates. And if your ventricles are going to go at 300 or 600 times a minute, then there's going to be very, very little time for ventricular diastole, no filling, decreased cardiac output, coronary ischemia, ventricular fibrillation, which will ultimately result and lead to death. So this is what you would typically see. This is an ECG showing you QRSs which are having different shades. Some are broad, some are not so broad. That's because some beats are coming down the AV node, some are coming down the axillary pathways, and there's different percentage of activation of the ventricular kingdom by accessory pathway and AV node based on their respective refractory periods, leading to an irregular heart rate with different shades of QRS width. And this is a very, very serious problem because you're having atrial fibrillation with pre-excitation, which can lead to death. So I still remember we had a 15-year-old girl when I was in Canada at that time who had come with a WPW with a history of syncope, and we advised her that she needed to have an ablation, but she said no because she had a prom coming up, and prom is one of those parties they have in school when they finish 10th standard. So she wanted to sort of freak out in the party, and she didn't want to have any procedure before that. So she went to the party and she had some pegs of alcohol. 15-year-old in Canada, the culture is different from our country. We have a much better culture. And as a result, when you could actually see what was happening to her, she had pre-excited tachycardia going on over here. And very soon, even the defib monitor will say, check the patient, because the patient actually died. So that girl never came back to her. She passed away thanks to this tachycardia. So that's the importance of treating WPW with respect in the pediatric population. So that brings us to the point that, you know, you may have a child who's actually had some other problem, was admitted for some other surgery or something, like a hernia or something else, at which time an ECG was done as part of pre-op and a WPW was formed. And when you have a WPW and a child, obviously you're wondering what to tell. You know, the child has not complained of palpitations, child has had no symptoms whatsoever. Do you do something about it? Do you take the child for an ablation? Do you give drugs to the child, or do you leave the child alone? So that brings us to the point that these children need to be risk stratified. If the child is a low risk, you will leave the child alone. If the child is a high risk, then you will need to do something about it. So how do you risk stratify? One way of risk stratifying is to do a exercise testing. Put the child on the treadmill and look at whether you can see if the child is having WPW on exercising, does the pre-excitation disappear? But very important to understand that when the child is exercising on the treadmill, if it's a 5 or 6 year old child and the child is happy to run the treadmill, the child's catecholamines are going to be building up. So the AV node is going to get slicker and slicker. And remember, your pre-excitation is an ongoing competition between the AV node and the accessory pathway. So if your pre-excitation gradually disappears, it does not mean that you are able to ascertain what the accessory pathway's refractory period is. So when you're looking at a treadmill trace, you can see pre-excitation over here, but here there's an abrupt loss of pre-excitation. If you have an abrupt loss of pre-excitation, then you know that at this rate, the pathway could no longer conduct. And this would give you the refractory period of the accessory pathway, And if your accessory pathway refractory period was less than 240 milliseconds, then you know it's a high-risk pathway, and you would have to counsel the family for having the child to take medication or to have an ablation procedure. However, if you notice that the pre-acceleration disappeared and the RR interval was very large, like 300 milliseconds or more, then you know it's a low-risk pathway. But there are some fallacies, and the fallacies are that, like I said, you should look at an abrupt disappearance of pre-acceleration, not a gradual disappearance. And secondly, it's very important for you to understand that left-sided pathways, though capable of anterograde conduction, may not be very easily seen because the current just takes too long to reach there before it reaches the AV node. So the treadmill is not a foolproof method, though if you have something like this happening, you can be reasonably sure. So what do you do? If you actually find out that it's a high-risk pathway, you would either consider ablation or medication. If the child is less than 5 years of age and the pathway is high-risk, it's better to manage the child on drugs. But if the child is more than 5 years of age, then ablation is something which would be strongly recommended for a high-risk pathway. Now, what we usually do, and we are, I think, probably the only center in India and one of two centers in Asia that test this, and that is the esophageal EP study. So we do an esophageal EP study in all our children who have accessory pathways to ascertain what the risk of the pathway is. And you obviously don't want to do an invasive procedure if you can avoid it. And this is like putting in a rice tube, and you can see clearly from the cartoon that if somebody were to stab you from the back, the first chamber of the heart they would enter into would be the left atrium. Because the left atrium is very much at the back, and just behind the left atrium comes your esophagus. So you can put in a probe through this, an electrode catheter, and through this you can actually pace the atrium. You can induce atrial fibrillation, or you can do programmed atrial pacing through which you can ascertain the refractory period of the accessory pathway. And once you ascertain the refractory period of the accessory pathway, you know whether the child has a high-risk pathway or a low-risk pathway. Because you must understand that all anti-arrhythmic drugs have got side effects, whether it is flecainide or whether it's amiodarone, every drug has got side effects. So you must be very, very, very cautious about how long and when you want to give a drug to a child. You don't want to give a drug to a child unnecessarily. So a high-risk accessory pathway needs to be managed appropriately. And you need to be clear whether you're dealing with a high-risk pathway or not. And the esophageal EP study helps a great deal in doing that. And once you know you're having a high-risk pathway, then you need to go ahead and either manage it with an ablation or with medication. We now move on to PJRT. Dr. Kannan sir actually spoke about this. He mentioned this to you in his slides when he was showing you a tachycardia ECG. So PJRT actually expands for paroxysmal junctional reciprocating tachycardia. It's a misnomer. And it actually is an orthodromic AVRT where the accessory pathway conducts slowly. So remember, in our previous case, when we were talking about AVRT, we saw that the current travels down the AV node and then goes up the pathway to the atrium. So this pathway conducts fast. Because it conducts fast, the ventricles are activated, you get your QRS, then the pathway conducts fast, and then you have your atria activating, getting your P wave. So your QRS happens, and about 70 milliseconds after that, your P wave happens. So it's a short RP tachycardia. But let's say this pathway is a lazy pathway. It doesn't conduct fast. Its conduction velocity is slow. In that case, the impulse will travel down, activate the ventricles, and then take time to travel up to activate the atria. So your RP interval will become long. So you'll have a long RP tachycardia, but the mechanism is the same. It's an orthodromic AVRT, but a long RP tachycardia because you have a slowly conducting accessory pathway. And that is what you call a PJRT. So again, you can see that your atria are going to be activated from down to top. So your inferior leads, there is 2, 3 AVF, 2 will be sitting here, AVF will be here, 2 will be there, and 3 will be here. They are all looking, and current is traveling away from them. So your P waves are going to be negative in 2, 3 AVF. Your RP interval is going to be long. So if you were to look at the ECG for somebody with a PJRT, you will see nice, beautiful negative P waves in 2, 3 AVF, but your RP is very long. It's a short PR, long RP tachycardia. So when you see a short PR, long RP tachycardia. One of your differentials is going to be a PJRP. So from there, I just want to briefly show you this is the tachycardia initiation. You can see a PAC happens here. The PAC occurs, resulting in current traveling down the AV node, up the accessory pathway, and leading to this negative P wave, and tachycardia has got initiated. So, you know, when you have a tachycardia initiation or a tachycardia termination, you're really blessed. And it's something very important to try to capture if you can capture it, because it gives you a lot of information. You then move on to the next commonest arrhythmia that you see in the children, and that's AV nodal reentrant tachycardia. In AV nodal reentrant tachycardia, the circuit involves the lower part of the atria and the AV node. And you often have these children presenting to you with malaise, fluttering, pallor, nausea. You know, small kids, infants, neonates, they're not going to tell you that they're having palpitations. So it's important for you to sort of be able to pick it up. Usually the mother brings the child saying failure to thrive, child has become dull over the last 2 days, not feeding properly, excessive sweating. And then you check the heart rate, you find the heart rate is high, you do an ECG, and you find that you've got a tachycardia on your hands. Now, remember I told you AVRT is an arrhythmia that is most commonly seen in younger age groups. As the children get older, the incidence of AVRT reduces and the incidence of AVNRT increases. So if you have a 13 or 14 year old child, an adolescent kid presenting to you with an SVT for the first time, the odds that it is going to be an AVNRT is going to be really high. So here's a cartoon where you can clearly see this is your AV node, you have a bundle of His, and you've got two ways in which you can enter the AV node. There's a fast way and a slow way. So the story is the same. You have re-entry, you have a PAC that comes, it travels down, it's not able to go down the fast pathway because the fast pathway is refractory. It goes down the slow pathway, resulting in tachycardia. So the initial impulse comes down both pathways, and then when the PAC happens, the PAC is not able to go down one, it's blocked down the fast, it comes down the slow pathway, goes down to activate the His bundle, and then leads to tachycardia. So it goes down the slow pathway, traveling down to activate the His bundle. As it's traveling down to activate the His bundle, it's traveling up to activate the atria. So you must understand that here, your ventricles and atria are not in series. In the previous picture that I showed you for AVRT, I told you that the ventricles and the atria are in series. The ventricle had to be activated, then the pathway had to be activated, then the atria had to be activated. So you cannot have atrial activation unless the ventricle and the pathway were activated. Whereas here, the ventricle and the atria are in parallel. It's going down to the bundle of His to activate the ventricle. Same time, it's traveling up the fast pathway to activate the atria. So it's a competition between whether it can go up the fast pathway or go down the bundle of His. Who defeats who? And these are both fast guys, mind you. The His bundle conducts very fast. The fast pathway conducts very fast. So you're having two really fast guys. It's like Carl Lewis and Ben Johnson competing with each other. Two really fast guys competing with each other, running in opposite directions. So if this guy beats that guy, your QRS will happen before your P wave. If that guy beats this guy, the P wave happens before the QRS. Invariably, what happens is both of them time out almost the same time. So you have your P wave and QRS happening at the same time. So you don't see your P wave. Your P wave is buried in your QRS. But if the QRS were to beat the P wave, it will beat the P wave by a small margin, not by a huge margin, which is why we use that golden number of 70 milliseconds. And when I said you have a short RP tachycardia, if the RP is more than 70 milliseconds, you're thinking orthodromic AVRT because the ventricle and the atria are in series. But if you're having a RP interval of less than 70 milliseconds, you're thinking typical slow fast AVNRT. So here you can see this, I have just magnified this over here. You see the small P wave sitting here at the end of the QRS. That P wave is a short RP tachycardia, suggestive of a typical slow fast AVNRT, impulse traveling down the slow pathway and then going up the fast pathway. But you must understand that these pathways, slow and fast, can change. The fast pathway may not be so fast, it may be slow. So you may have two slow pathways, of which one is really slow and one is slightly slow. So where your P wave falls is totally depending on how quickly this guy can conduct. If this guy conducts super fast, the P wave is going to be buried in the QRS. Or it may even beat the QRS. If this guy conducts really slowly, the P wave is going to happen way after the QRS. So you can have a wide range, and your P wave can come really far after the QRS, making it a short RP tachycardia, a short PR, long RP tachycardia, or you can have a short RP tachycardia. So a typical slow pulse AVNRT will be a short RP tachycardia, but an atypical AVNRT where your fast pathway is not really fast. So an atypical AVNRT is like a fast slow AVNRT. You will have a long RP and a short PR interval. From there, we move on to atrial tachycardias. Atrial tachycardias have this typical warm-up phenomenon. That is, you know, you'll have a few beats going fast, then slows down, again fast, slow, that kind of thing. And atrial tachycardias are usually ectopic atrial tachycardias. You have one focus that's irritable, keeps firing. So you cannot overdrive pace these tachycardias. So atrial tachycardias can be due to re-entry within the atria, or they can be due to automaticity, where you have one focus which automatically fires. So if you have a reentrant atrial tachycardia, you can terminate it by pacing. So again, in the pediatric age group, we don't like to cardiovert children. We would try to terminate arrhythmias without having to cardiovert, because cardioversion can cause damage to the heart. So child presents to you with an arrhythmia in your emergency, you will try to manage it medically. Try carotid sinus massage, try adenosine. If all these things don't help and the child is hemodynamically unstable, that is the only time you will think of cardioversion. So when you're dealing with an atrial arrhythmia and it is due to re-entry, if you did a transesophageal pacing, you can terminate it every time the re-entry happened. But if it was an automatic atrial tachycardia, pacing is not going to help. Atrial tachycardias are quite uncommon in pediatric population, less than 10%. But in children who have complex congenital heart disease, the many conditions that Dr. Kannan spoke to you about, like TAPVC or TGA or tricuspid atresia, all these conditions are associated with disease in the atrium, and that leads to atrial arrhythmias taking place. So atrial tachycardias, these are the usual foci where atrial arrhythmias occur. They usually occur in areas where the veins meet the atrial chambers, or in the crista terminalis, which is smooth and the rough part of the atria meet each other. So this is an ECG of an atrial tachycardia, and this shows you the clear warm up, warm down phenomenon. You know, tuck, 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 it goes fast, then slows down. Slows down again, tuck, 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 picks up. You know, this typical warm up, warm down that you see is very, very typical of an ectopic atrial tachycardia focus. The other thing is, I told you, when you get an ECG and you actually have the termination of the ECG, tachycardia, that gives you valuable information. So if you have a tachycardia that terminates with a P wave, it is not an atrial tachycardia. When an atrial tachycardia terminates, it will terminate with a QRS. Because you have this focus that's firing, and when the focus keeps firing very rapidly, every single beat travels down the AV node to give you a QRS. So when the focus stops firing, the last beat will go down to give you a QRS. So your last beat that you will see activation will be the ventricular activation. You cannot have an atrial activation being the last event in an atrial tachycardia. For that to happen, your atrial tachycardia has decided to stop firing, and at the same time, the AV node decided to stop conducting. And it is really absurd as to why these two should sort of play ball with each other. Why should the atrial focus decide to stop firing and the AV node decide to stop conducting at the same time? There's no reason why they should do that. They're not like, you know, having some secret allegiance with each other. So if you see a tachycardia ending with a P wave, it is not an atrial tachycardia. It rules out an atrial tachycardia. We then move on to atrial flutter. Atrial flutter, again, like I said, is usually seen in the post-op setting. So you have infants born with tricuspid atresia, TGA, TAPVC, TOF. They all have surgeries. Surgeries lead to scars. All these babies will have surgeries where their people are cutting into their atria to operate. So a scar is formed, and where the scar forms, you have re-entry happening around the scar, and that leads to flutters. So atrial flutters are not AV node dependent. So you give adenosine, the tachycardia will still continue. So you look at an ECG like this, you must sort of look at it very carefully, and you will realize that there are a lot of P waves running through. And so it's basically an atrial flutter. So when you have an atrial flutter, again, the treatment, if you have the facility to do esophageal pacing, then you can pace terminate the flutter transesophageally. And then you will have to plan further treatment either with medications or with ablation. Dr. Lawrence will speak to you about these things in future. So I don't want to sort of go into that. So this is a typical clockwise flutter where the circuit is going around in the tricuspid cable, tricuspid isthmus, going around the tricuspid annulus and leading to atrial flutter. Every now and then the impulse knocks on the AV node and activates the ventricle. but because there is no accessory pathway, this person's ventricles will not go very fast, because the AV node will allow only one in three or four of those impulses to come down. Now, just briefly, I'll mention about ventricular tachycardia to you for completion purposes. Ventricular tachycardia is something you don't usually see in children. And if you saw ventricular tachycardia in children, in people, kids who have structurally normal heart, you're always thinking of idiopathic VTs. So fascicular VT is something that's common, particularly young boys. Typical story is like a 8 or 10 year old boy having a birthday party, running around with his friends, and then develops tachycardia. So that's the typical presentation of a fascicular VT. And fascicular VTs are very responsive to calcium channel blockers like verapamil or diltiazem. In fact, IV verapamil is the drug of choice to terminate it. Unfortunately, IV verapamil is not available in India. India manufactures IV verapamil and sells it to foreign countries. But if you try to buy IV verapamil in India, you can't find it because it's not profitable for the pharmaceutical companies to sell it in India. So that's a big shame, and it would be nice if we can have IV verapamil, because it's made in our country but sold in foreign countries and we don't have it. So when we have a child coming in with fascicular VT, you're sort of stuck because that essential drug is not there to terminate the tachycardia. The other common arrhythmia that's seen in kids can be RVOT VT, which is catecholamine mediated. In kids, when you have VT, you're also thinking of other things like long QT syndrome, CPVT, digoxin. Taking a history is extremely important, very, very important to take a good history from kids. I had this 15-year-old girl who came to me, and then I asked her, so has anybody died in the family? She said, no. And then I asked her repeatedly, did you have any brothers, any sisters? And then she said, our Anna, and that Anna had died, meaning that she had a brother earlier who had died. And then when you ask how the brother died, she said that he died because of a snake bite. And then you ask, what snake bit him? She says, I don't know what snake bit him, because she's not seen the snake. Apparently, he was running around and playing in the ground, and he was found suddenly to have died. And the friend said that a snake must have bitten him. But there was no snake. And this child actually had CPVT. So the brother who died also probably died of CPVT, which is an exercise-induced ventricular tachycardia. So when you have ventricular tachycardia in children, you're always thinking, you must think of other possibilities like long QT and CPVT. Rarely you can have malignancies in the heart which can cause tachycardia, and that you will pick up on an echo. I'm not going to management in depth, but I'm going to highlight a few points. Dr. Lawrence will deal with the management. So I'll just cover up with 2-3 points and then finish my talk. Like I told you, you don't like to cardiovert children unless they're hemodynamically unstable. So you will not jump into cardioversion. And the other thing is vagal maneuvers. Now, when you are giving a vagal maneuver to terminate a tachycardia, you need to be rough about it, because the whole idea is that you're going to catch the child by surprise to terminate the tachycardia. So you want a sudden vagal outflow to lead to an AV nodal block, which will lead to a termination of an AV NRT or an AV RT, which are AV node dependent tachycardia. So you want to catch the child by surprise. So the ways you do it is, one is to shove ice on the face of the child. So you get ice from the refrigerator in your hospital and put it inside a cloth. And while the child is lying down, without the child realizing what you're going to do, you suddenly put all the ice on the child's face. And the child sort of gasps with an increased vagal outflow, and that leads to termination of tachycardia. The other thing is to shove a thermometer rectally. It may sound rude. Again, the sudden pain and the discomfort when you shove that thermometer into the rectum of the child will cause the child to gasp and will cause the arrhythmia to terminate because of an increased outflow of the vagal outflow. Same way, rise tube insertion causes the same thing, discomfort. When the child is an adult child, like, you know, a teenager or about 10-year-old child, you can try to tell the child to do a Valsalva, or you can try carotid sinus massage. But important to understand that all these vagal maneuvers have to be tried early once the arrhythmia is set in. So a child has come in with arrhythmia for the last 1 to 2 hours, you try it, you're likely to be successful. But if the child has been in arrhythmia for 8-10 hours, then you're unlikely to be successful with a vagal maneuver, because the catecholamines circulating in the child are so high that whatever amount of vagal kick you try to give, it is in no way going to overcome the amount of catecholamines circulating in the child. And lastly, I also wanted to reiterate the point of the transesophageal pacing. So you can use that to terminate arrhythmias as well. So reentrant arrhythmias like AVRT and AVNRT, the PJRT that Dr. Kannan spoke to you about, these lead to incessant tachycardias. So child comes in failure, you need to sort of, and you start medications, but the medications will take time to act. if you have this probe in and you can keep pacing from here, terminating the arrhythmia, you can sort of buy time, help the ventricular function to improve, and then take the child in a better shape for the procedure, like an ablation procedure. So I'll stop with this, and we can have Dr. Lawrence speak to you on the management. Thank you so much for your patient hearing.
Thank you, sir. Can I have my slides? Sir, you can stop sharing, sir. Roshan, sir.
I'm just doing this.
Thank you, sir. Good morning, all. Thank you, Kannan sir and Roshan sir, for excellent presentation. It made my job really easy. I think we have close to 1,200 participants who are watching that webinar right now. So my topic for presentation will be very short. I'm not going to go in all detail about management of arrhythmias in children. But what I'm going to do is, I'm going to give a little bird's eye view of what we are going to manage. So yeah, let me start now. So if we are worried about arrhythmias in children, so arrhythmias in children, they present with symptoms like that can disrupt their daily activities. They can have dizziness or LOC. They can have ventricular dysfunction if it is an incessant arrhythmia. The most importantly, a lot of time the children, parents and relatives are going to ask about activity, sports activity particularly related to these children. Many pediatric arrhythmias, although they don't require any restrictions, most often the patient themselves, they know the symptoms which stimulates their arrhythmias or precipitates their arrhythmia, they self-restrict. They should know which symptoms should be worried or which symptom not to be worried. And more importantly, we know very well there are some arrhythmias and some conditions where sports may present a unique risk. Particularly swimming, we know Long-QT syndrome has been long been implicated to be a cause of sudden cardiac death in children who indulge in swimming. So the most important is you have to assess the patient for risk of collapse and sudden cardiac death. We should understand this is rare. This is a rare condition in children. Sometimes it's related to exertion. So we should be very careful in diagnosing this. While we talk about sudden cardiac death, we should know the facts. If you look at sudden arrhythmic death in children, if you take less than 1 year old, it's around 80 in 1 lakh. If it is more than 1 year old, it's 3 in 1 lakh. If it is 0.6 in high school students, if you see a high school students, it's around 0.6 in 1 lakh students. There is a conflicting data on athletes versus non-athletes. We don't have a great data. Most of the data I'm presenting is from United States. And most importantly, you should understand minority are arrhythmic, not all sudden deaths in children are due to cardiac arrhythmias. So if you look at sudden arrhythmic death syndrome in total, around 350,000 arrhythmic sudden deaths per year happens in children in US. So around 4,000 people are less than 35 year old. We can characterize young people. So when you should worry? So there are warning signs in children which you take it very seriously. Any syncope in a children, I recognize atypical syncope because we know a lot of kids have a typical vasovagal syncope in school, standing in a pair for a long time, standing in a queue for a long time and all that we see regularly. So that if you leave out that syncopes, atypical syncopes, which gives you a suspicion of some serious underlying illness, you have to take it very seriously. Atypical seizures is one of the very common presentation in young kids and children. They are typical presentations. If you have atypical presentations of seizures, suddenly a kid comes to you, the parents say that every time a kid does an exercise or plays in the ground, develops convulsions. This is not a typical convulsions you see in your clinical practice. When you have atypical seizures, you have to be very careful. As already Dr. John Roshan told you once, any concerning family history, you have to take it very seriously. If you have any family history of sudden cardiac death in children, young kids, in the family has to be taken in very seriously. All the cardiac arrhythmias which have a strong family history have very high risk of recurrence. You have to be cautious when you when a child talks about chest pain, when you see a harsh murmur or concerning clinical examination finding like a elevated JVP and signs of congestive heart failure in a children, you have to be careful. The patient has an arrhythmia with a known congenital heart disease, you have to be cautious because they can have a serious arrhythmias. When you can just relax when you have a palpitations or an arrhythmia, the kid complain of isolated palpitations without any coexisting symptoms. The palpitation lasts for a few seconds, few minutes. It's so short that they are not able to document any time. I always say most of my patients and relatives, the arrhythmia which comes in goes in so fast, it's unlikely to be pathological until unless it's in the very early phase. Sometimes kids start having arrhythmias like this, slowly they become sustained. So you have a kid complaining of an isolated palpitation which is lasting for very few seconds, you may just reassure them after looking at other parameters. The kid does not have any family or personal history suggestive of any serious illness in the family, close family, and you find normal clinical examination. So these are the times when you have, when your kid complains of palpitation, you can take it and assess in a relaxed way. Whenever a kid comes to your OPD, when you think about an arrhythmia, when they complain of palpitations at rest, when the palpitations start and stop, when a young patient complains of chest pain along with palpitations, you have, as I told you, that we see few faintings like vasovagal in kids. If you see any fainting which is atypical, that is, kid complains of a palpitation, syncope preceded by a palpitation, and palpitation happens without any warning. Palpitation preceded by mild exertion. You have a near drowning in a capable swimmer. The kid, which is the swimmer by nature who swims regularly, suddenly have a near drowning. So that is very uncommon for a capable swimmer. So you have to take it seriously. As I already told you, atypical seizures, typically not responsive to anti-epileptic medications. The epileptologist tells you that in spite of multiple hello, can you able to see my slides?
Sir, we are seeing only the first slide, the hospital slide. We have not seen any other slide.
Okay. I'm not sure why I'm not moving my slides. Let me see. Can you see my slides moving now? Can you see my slides moving now?
Not moving, no, not moving, sir.
So you have to restart again. Just cough it and again restart that.
I'll restart again. Okay. Can you see my slides now?
Yes, now it's moving.
Okay.
Yeah, it's moving. Now. Go ahead. Yeah.
Thank you, sir. Thank you. Okay, I think had some problem with my slides. Hopefully, I think my audio was okay. So I'll go on with the further slides. So this was what I was talking about. Whenever you have an arrhythmia or palpitations at rest, sudden or stopping immediately, younger patient with chest pain, atypical faintings, syncope or presyncope preceded by palpitations, near drowning in a capable swimmer, and atypical seizures. These are the things we should be worried in the children and a possibility of an arrhythmia. Particularly, I was talking about convulsions, which are not responsive to anti-epileptic medications. This is very common. You may get a call from an epileptologist saying that this kid's coming with a recurrent seizures, but the kids, seizures are not controlled by escalation of anti-epileptic medications. We have seen quite a number of kids in recent times, at least with long QT syndrome, typically. The long QT syndrome, you know very well, it's a syndrome which you are most commonly going to see in children. They go to epileptologist. Sometimes there's no documented arrhythmia. I've seen one kid who had no documented arrhythmia, recurrent convulsions, was put on a video EEG. The video EEG has one ECG lead. So when the video EEG was recording a episode of convulsions, the ECG was showing ventricular tachycardia, tarsus, three pointers. So whenever you have a kid which does not have any structural disease in the brain, and as are convulsions not controlled by escalation of antiepileptic therapy, you have to be very careful. You have to take a proper history and look into the ECG properly. And you have convulsions which are brought about by emotion and exertion. These are not very usual precipitants of a convulsions. When you have a convulsions brought about by all this, you have to think about arrhythmias. And a child presents with a sudden cardiac arrest. You receive a kid have the subarted sudden cardiac arrest. You have to think about arrhythmias. You have no obvious cause or known diagnosis. In a child who presented with sudden cardiac arrest, which has been revived, you have to think about a serious arrhythmias. You have a family member of the particular kid who has a pacemaker, ICD, or any cardiac interventions, or any documented malignant arrhythmias. Any family member with a sudden cardiac death at a younger age, less than 40 or 50, you have to take history of not only kids in the family who had a sudden cardiac death, you have to look at young adults in the family who have got a cardiac illness. You know very well that hypertrophic cardiomyopathy has a wide presentation when you look at the age. You may have a family member who had a sudden cardiac arrest with hypertrophic cardiomyopathy at the age of 25, 30, but a child may have got an aggressive form of hypertrophic cardiomyopathy with ventricular arrhythmias at a younger age. So having a history of all family members is very important. So this is very important when you are looking at arrhythmias. This is why you are very much worried in kids with arrhythmias. In kids, we see channelopathies like long QT syndrome, Brugada syndrome, or CPVT. These are the arrhythmias have most common presentation during childhood. We see a lot of kids with long QTs nowadays being referred because a lot of pediatricians have been started picking up. Looking at a QT interval in any kid presenting with giddiness, dizziness, or syncope is very important. This is not a very rare disorder. If you have a large population like ours, there's a possibility that every pediatrician may see once in a while case of a long QT syndrome. So looking at a ECG is very important. You have arrhythmias which have a high ventricular arrhythmia risk, like cardiomyopathies, like arrhythmogenic right ventricular cardiomyopathy. They have very high chances of developing a ventricular arrhythmia. As I already told you, hypertrophic cardiomyopathy. So you have to be careful about these things when you are dealing with syncope in children. The rhythms we have already discussed by Dr. Kannan sir and Roshan sir about multiple cardiac rhythms. The rhythms which have to be, you have to be careful. You always worried when have a resuscitated cardiac arrest. You have a documented ventricular fibrillation. The baby or kid had a documented polymorphic ventricular tachycardia. ECG showed prolonged pauses with a baseline sinus bradycardia or AV blocks. You have to be cautious when you see a WBW syndrome. It has been amply explained by Dr. Roshan sir, the risk of sudden cardiac death in WBW syndrome. Any kid presenting with heart blocks, sinus pauses, slow supraventricular tachycardias, incessant arrhythmias, and ventricular tachycardias. These are the arrhythmias you have to be cautious. When you have most of the supraventricular tachycardias are hemodynamically stable, the kid reasonably tolerates most of the arrhythmias. We know most of these arrhythmias are not malignant. They can be managed either medically or via curative way of radiofrequency ablation. You have a fascicular VT, which is very much treatable in children, and they usually don't cause any significant issues. We don't see a sudden cardiac death kind of a situation with these kind of ventricular tachycardias. Or isolated ventricular or atrial ectopics in a structurally normal heart, you need not worry much. And sinus tachycardias may be inappropriate. Sinus tachycardias, which are not very uncommon in children, you need not worry too much. So whenever you see an arrhythmia, there is a joint care between a pediatrician and a cardiologist or an electrophysiologist. The initial evaluation of an arrhythmia should include a 12-lead ECG. You cannot underestimate or underline importance of 12-lead ECG. Whenever you have an arrhythmia, having a 12-lead ECG is very important because you have to decide about further course of action, medications, and if the child needs a further intervention, and to prognostify the kids, further prognosis to parents and relatives. Some kids may require extended Holters or loop recorders. You have to patiently wait. Always I say that whenever your child complains of palpitation, which lasts for a few seconds, we need not worry too much until unless you have a high-risk signs, as I already told you in the previous slides. If you don't have any high-risk signs, you can wait. Most arrhythmias, if they are pathological, sooner or later, kid will develop a sustained arrhythmia. This sustained arrhythmia can be captured in an ECG. Most often we tell the parents, if the child complains of a few seconds of arrhythmia, don't worry, you don't rush to the hospital. If you are not able to record the ECG, fine. Sooner or later, she will or he will have a palpitation which lasts longer, where you can go and take an ECG and come back to me. So you have to patiently wait for the episode to be documented. Sometimes you require an additional testing. Most of the kids who complains of palpitations or arrhythmia require a basic echocardiogram to rule out any structural abnormalities. As already Dr. John Roshantar told you, that WWE syndrome, you can do a stress testing to identify the refractory period of the pathway. You may require a cardiac MRI. You see, nowadays we call structurally normal heart only after a cardiac MRI is normal, because there are some abnormalities like early ARVCs and hypertrophic cardiomyopathy in early phases, or any infiltrative disorders can be missed in very early phase of illness. MRI picks up most of them. So most of the kids which have a suspicions for all these diseases can have a cardiac MRI. So you need most of the laboratory study. Some of them may require an EP study if you feel it's a life-threatening arrhythmia which has an excellent cure. So ultimately you end up in a treatment options. General treatment options will require simple observation. You have medications. Some kids or children, if they have a significant arrhythmia, may require a daily prophylactic or maintenance therapy. Or if the arrhythmias are rare and infrequent, you may suggest a pill-in-pocket therapy. We have antiarrhythmics or beta blockers which can be taken when the tachycardia comes in. We have drugs like flecainide which can be used as a pill-in-the-pocket therapy in infrequent and rare arrhythmias. Some kids, if they have a illness which can be completely cured and significant arrhythmia, you can suggest them a EP study and radiofrequency ablation. Bradyarrhythmias may require a permanent pacemaker implantation. A significant channelopathies like long QT or CPVD in a patients who are refractory to medical therapy, or some form of long QTs like type 3 may require ICD as a primary therapy for prevention of sudden cardiac death. Surgical therapy is very uncommon, kids. Mostly it's a complex congenital heart disease situation where you may require surgical procedures in kids to take care of arrhythmias. I'll just touch upon few basic management protocols. Already has been few touched by Dr. John Roshan, sir. In AV nodal re-entry or AV re-entry due to pathways, always attempt a vagal maneuver in early phase. If unsuccessful, the most common drug we use in a pediatric age group is adenosine. You can use them as 100 microgram per kg in a rapid bolus. You can increase the dose and repeat. Only contraindication I feel in a kid remains active bronchospasm. So only take if you have a history of acute bronchospasm, you consider not to give this drug. Otherwise, highly effective drug in children with hardly any hemodynamic issues. As told already, we can use synchronized cardioversion if your drugs are not working and kid is hemodynamically unstable. Usually for a supraventricular tachycardia, you require a lesser dosage. A 0.5 joules per kg should be good enough for converting a supraventricular tachycardia. If you have a pediatric paddles, good. If you don't have, you can try adult paddles itself, but you keep the energy at 0.5 joules per kg. Most of the places, as we have seen in previous slides or previous speakers have told you, like rather than going for a cardioversion, you can try intravenous amiodarone. If you have an experience with trying amiodarone, you can try intravenous amiodarone in most of the SVTs also, because you know amiodarone has multiple actions. One of the earliest action amiodarone can have is a beta blocking action. So this beta blocking action can help you in terminating the tachycardia. So with the available drugs right now, we have adenosine is the safest. If you are done with adenosine, tachycardia is still not terminating, you can consider amiodarone. If amiodarone is not working, or if you have a kid with a hemodynamic instability, which is very unlikely in an AV nodal reentry, you can consider a cardioversion. The prognosis, the probability of complete resolution depends on age of onset. The majority of infants diagnosed up to 1 year of age have an excellent prognosis. They may not see their arrhythmia at all. Close to 35 to 40% of them may not see arrhythmia at all. So if you have a kids which is more than 1 year at the first episode of SVT, there's a possibility that you may have to treat it, because complete resolution is not very common after 1 year of age. The maintenance therapy, you can use beta blockers in recurrent arrhythmias. Digoxin and calcium channel blockers, you use only when you see clearly that kid does not have a WWE syndrome. with a significant risk for atrial flutter or fibrillation. I usually avoid, if you have any documented YQRS tachycardia in a kid with WWE syndrome, you have to better avoid these drugs because they can block AV node and allow unhindered conduction of these signals into the ventricle, causing ventricular fibrillation. So sotalol, flecainide, amiodarone may be necessary in some patients with medical control of SVTs. I myself prefer, rather than starting this drug, consider a radiofrequency ablation because most of these antiarrhythmics have some side effects, and except for flecainide, which has been used extensively in children, other drugs have a long-term maintenance doses may have a toxic issues. So I prefer, if the kid is maintained by a beta blocker, I'm happy, I can prolong as much as possible. If beta blocker is not effective or on beta blocker kid develops arrhythmias, I preferably take the kid for radiofrequency ablation. Ectopic atrial tachycardias, you know very well, they poorly respond to adenosine and DC cardioversion until unless they have a reentry as a mechanism, because DC cardioversion will not work on your automated tachycardias. The first line of management could be your antiarrhythmics like amiodarone. You can load them with 5 mg per kg bolus over 20 to 30 minutes. I prefer more than that. I usually give a bolus more than 1 hour. So give a bolus of amiodarone more than 1 hour, can be followed by amiodarone maintenance of 10 to 15 mg per kg per day. Minimally symptomatic patients may not require acute treatment. You can consider only a maintenance therapy. So one important thing in pediatric arrhythmias you should be aware of is tachycardiomyopathy. The incessant arrhythmias can produce ventricular dysfunction. Atrial tachycardias, if they present more than 90% of the time, they can have a ventricular dysfunction. We call it as a tachycardiomyopathy. If the PVCs or ventricular arrhythmias are present more than 24% of the time in total sinus rhythm, they can develop a ventricular dysfunction. With conversion to normal sinus rhythm, ventricular dysfunction completely improves. Kids can become completely normal. You can consider a electrical cardioversion in this kid. Some of them are hemodynamically unstable because of LV dysfunction, so you can consider an electrical cardioversion. You can try medications like antiarrhythmics, or ablation is curative. So most of these ectopic atrial tachycardias are usually fascicular VTs can present as a ventricular dysfunction and tachycardiomyopathy. The moment you ablate a ventricular arrhythmia or an arrhythmia which is causing tachycardiomyopathy, that LV function can improve. So in atrial tachycardias, close to 50% of the kids can have a complete resolution of arrhythmia. So children younger than 3 years of age have a higher incidence of ectopic tachycardia resolution versus the older children. The older children who had an onset of atrial arrhythmia after 3 years of age, as already told by John Roshan, sir, atrial arrhythmias are not the most common arrhythmias in children. So if they have a children with the atrial tachycardia which have onset after 3 years of age, that's a possibility that the kid may require a radiofrequency ablation. Pediatric ventricular tachycardias, you have to be careful about them. You have to be worried when it presents with syncope or near syncope, with a poor hemodynamic status, presence of congenital heart disease like tetralogy of Fowler or complex ventricular anatomies, or cardiomyopathy and heart failure, presenting with myocarditis and ventricular arrhythmias. This is a dangerous subset. You have to be very careful and concerning family history. A family history of heart disease or sudden cardiac death. If unstable, asynchronous cardioversion at a dose of 2 joules per kg is very useful. You can increase the dose up to 4 to 5 joules per kg if it is not converted. If stable, you can consider using amiodarone bolus. Here, amiodarone bolus has to be given a little faster. I prefer at 30 to 60 minutes, bolus followed by a maintenance therapy. Procainamide is not available in India, so I'm not going to talk about that. So, either ventricular tachycardia, hemodynamically unstable, cardioversion at 2 to 4 joules per kg. And if stable, you consider amiodarone. In structurally normal heart, ventricular tachycardias are well tolerated. Monomorphic ventricular tachycardias are particularly well tolerated, minimally symptomatic. The patient can be closely followed without a maintenance therapy. Beta blockers can reduce incidence. So if you have a symptomatic child, you can consider giving a beta blocker. Other diseases like channelopathies, long QT or Brugada or CPVT presenting at ventricular tachycardias has to be treated according to the available guidelines. Most of them suggest beta blockers, and you can consider implantable cardioverter defibrillators in a symptomatic patients who are refractory to medical treatment. Long QT syndrome, as I already told you, The most common arrhythmia you see in long QT syndrome is a Tarsus T-pointus. You will require an emergent cardioversion. Some may recover with magnesium sulfate and lignocaine may be useful. Increasing heart rate in long QT syndrome is always useful. When you have a long QT syndrome presenting with arrhythmia, one of the common intervention you can perform other than giving a cardioversion or a xylocaine is to increase the heart rate. Isoprolene can be useful. Isoprolene is usually a pro-arrhythmic drug. In this group of patients, by increasing the heart rate, it can be useful. So you can try that. Now, if it is an acquired long QT syndrome, you have to correct the underlying problem which has caused prolongation of QT. You bring out or pull out all the drugs which have caused QT prolongation. You find out all the drugs which can cause prolongation and pull them out of patient's treatment chart. So intravenous beta blockade may calm an adrenergic storm and help you to buy time. In a long term, beta blockers are very much useful. If they have a high risk features, may require an ICD. In short, about, I think there are so many antiarrhythmic drugs available in market. And problem with already, as Dr. John Roshan told you, there are a lot of drugs which are very good or not available in India. Like quinidine is not available in India. Procainamide is not available in India. IV verapamil is not available in India. So I have made a chart of drugs which are available right now in India, which you can use. Lignocaine is a good drug. Xylocard is really good in patients, particularly with the ventricular arrhythmias. Xylocard has action only down AV node. So you don't have any action on atrial arrhythmias. So you can use it for ventricular arrhythmias, particularly QT prolonging ventricular arrhythmias. Loading dose is 1 to 4 mg per kg. You can have a maintenance dose of 20 to 50 microgram per kg per minute until the arrhythmia is controlled. Mexiletin is available right now in India. You have mexiletin available. It is usually a oral drug. You can use it at 2 to 8 mg per kg in 3 divided doses. Mexiletin is reasonably well tolerated except for a few central nervous system side effects. You have availability of 50 and 150 mg doses available in India. So it is useful in pediatric age group, particularly for ventricular arrhythmias. This excellent drug has been recommended for type 3 QT, long QT prolongation, because most of your beta blockers does not have much of action in that group. Mexiletin is one of the drugs which has been advised in type 3 long QT syndrome. I'm not going into detail of all that because channelopathies on their own requires you around 45 minutes to 1 hour of lecture. So I'm just touching upon important points in particular syndromes. So flecainide is an excellent drug for pediatric population. I use a lot. Usual doses around 1 to 8 mg per kg per day. You can give in 2 to 3 divided doses. It is available in 50 to 100 mg doses. So you can use. This is a one drug which has been proven a lot in clinical practice in pediatric age group as an antiarrhythmic. I prefer it over amiodarone in most of the patients. Propranolol, of all beta blockers available, it's the one drug which has wonderful action on pediatric age group. You can use 1 to 4 mg per kg in 3 to 4 divided doses. You know very well, propranolol is available from 10 mg onwards. It is very easy to taper in pediatric age group. Particularly, you can powder it and divide it according to your need. This is a very good drug, particularly for most of the arrhythmias, starting from AV nodal reentry to AV reentry, up to your atrial tachycardias and long QT syndrome. Long QT syndrome type 1 and 2, beta blockers remain mainstay of treatment. Out of that, propranolol has excellent data. So that drug can be used in this group of patients. Esmolol of beta blockers, I prefer it for acute loading dose, particularly because this is a one beta blocker which is very rapid onset and offset in action. So the hemodynamics are not very bad. You can use it as 500 microgram per kg bolus or 1 to 2 minutes. And if you want, you can have a maintenance dose also. But I usually prefer it as a drug to convert arrhythmias because it goes off from body so fast that the hemodynamics can be recovered faster. So esmolol as a loading dose. Amiodarone is the most commonly used antiarrhythmic, easily available, and it takes care of most of the arrhythmias you know of, except for arrhythmias secondary to long QT syndrome. So you can use it as a oral loading dose. If you are looking at oral loading dose, it's 10 to 15 mg per kg over 5 to 10 days and change over to 2 to 5 mg per kg once a day for maintenance. If it is an IV, you start around 1 to 5 mg per kg over 1 to 2 hours or 5 to 15 mg per kg per minute as a maintenance dose. Verapamil, as I told you, IV verapamil is not available for clinical use in India right now. And IV verapamil, you have to be careful. IV verapamil has one strong contraindication in infants. Infants, it can cause asystole. So we don't recommend IV verapamil if it is available also for conversion of arrhythmias in infants less than 1 year of age. Oral verapamil is a really good drug. You can use it as 4 to 15 mg per kg in 4 divided doses. Dilsum, same calcium channel blocker. You can use either verapamil or diltiazem. Verapamil only problem we see in an adult age group is constipation. Younger age group, the doses used does not have much of trouble except for bradycardia and fatigue. Dilsum, it can be used at 0.5 to 2 mg per kg in divided doses. Adenosine, we already saw, you can give us a 100 microgram per kg as a first bolus. You can go up to 300 mg per kg, the maximum dose. So adenosine is a very safe drug, hardly cause any trouble to the kid, rather than a kid with a responsive airway can have a bronchospasm. Digoxin, I wanted to put a separate drug on slide on digoxin, because digoxin is the one drug which we are not commonly using in adult population nowadays, but pediatric still has a role. The drug is excreted in the urine unchanged and it crosses the placenta. That gives you an advantage. This remains one of the drug of choice for fetal arrhythmias, along with flecainide and sotalol. These are the three antiarrhythmics which can be used to treat fetal arrhythmias because they have a good concentration, because they cross the placental barrier, they can have a good concentration of drug in the fetus. So fetal arrhythmias can be treated with the oral drugs like digoxin, flecainide and sotalol. The oral dosing is usually a 30 to 50 microgram per kg loading dose over 24 hours. And you can give it then followed by divided doses into 7 to 10 mg per kg per day. IV dosing we hardly use nowadays. It's 2/3 of oral dosing. Pediatric bradycardia, because Dr. Don Roshan has not touched up, I thought I'll just put 2-3 slides on it. Sinus bradycardia is most commonly due to increased vagal tone. Secondary to ET disorders. Sinus node dysfunction you can have in postoperative congenital heart disease or familial sick sinus syndrome. Kids can have AV block. Secondary to congenital AV blocks, lupus RD mediated in kids, or intrinsic AV canal defect, or L-loop ventricles, postoperative or inherited. Pediatric bradyarrhythmias, when you are worried, symptomatic, fatigue, dizziness or syncope, severe bradycardia, postoperative heart block, if it persists more than 7 to 10 days in a postoperative patient, you have to consider a pacemaker. Family history of bradycardia, arrhythmias, atrial fibrillation and history of pacemakers or defibrillators, syncope or sudden unexplained death with a kid with a bradycardia, you have to be more careful. They may require a further treatment and may ultimately end up in a pacemaker. The final few slides, exercise and sport participation. You have to be careful with hypertrophic cardiomyopathy. The sports prescription has to be detailed to the kids and the parents, because this is one arrhythmia which can cause exertional syncope and ventricular arrhythmias. Long QT syndromes, typically type 1. They have an exertional tacits. CPVT is an arrhythmia of exertion. So patients develop ventricular arrhythmias whenever they exert. So these are the three arrhythmias which have to be very careful when you suggest sports prescription. You have to be cautious in most of the patients with HCM if they don't have a documented arrhythmia also. Long QT syndrome other than type 1. Patients with pacemakers and defibrillators, you have to be careful when a kid has a SVT. Sometimes SVT can be triggered with exertion. You can just inform the parents, need not worry, panic. If they have an SVT during exertion, can always be converted back to sinus rhythm. Need not worry too much. Most isolated ectopics may increase during exercise, but need not worry at all. So severe sport restrictions are almost always unnecessary in kids. Moving away from restriction towards assuring safe sports is more important. You have to tell the kids what are the symptoms they can develop. You have to tell them and teach them ability to stop and rest if needed. When to stop, it's very important. Keep most of the kids during exertion, you have to be well hydrated, because most of the arrhythmias which happen in a dehydrated child can have a syncope. So you keep them very hydrated during sports. In case of life-threatening situation, this is very, very difficult in our population. We don't have an AED everywhere. So you have to be very careful in kids, as I already showed you, kids with HCM, ventricular arrhythmias, history of sudden cardiac death in the family, long QT syndrome, type 1, CPVT. I would say that in our scenario, like kind of an environment, we have better not to exert them at all, because availability of automated external defibrillators is very much limited. Not allowing them to swimming alone, particularly in long QT syndrome, it's very important. To conclude, all types of arrhythmias are possible in pediatrics. Most of them are well tolerated. SVT is the most common and usually non-life-threatening arrhythmia. red flags always should raise a concern. The red flags are incessant arrhythmias, the presence of congenital heart disease, presence of WVW syndrome, inherited arrhythmia syndromes, including all your channelopathies, and a concerning family history. These are, when present, you have to be careful. These kids have to be treated carefully. So with this, I will close my presentation. Most of our presentations are available in our YouTube channel. You can go through it. Anybody who has missed can go. All of our presentation, previous presentations are available. You can see that. With this, I'll close my talk and we'll open up for discussion. I think both Kannan sir and Roshan sir is in line. Hello, sir.
Yeah. Thank you, Dr. Lawrence.
Sir, I think we can take questions, sir. You want to take your questions, sir? Kannan sir, you have few questions for you.
Okay, I am just going through that. Not many.
Yeah,
please. Okay, so majority are just wishes. How will you manage neonatal bradyarrhythmia? I think you told about that. Maybe you can answer it later. Again, somebody has asked to discuss the situs by ECG and X-ray.
Yeah, sir. That's the question. Yeah. I think 2-3 questions are there.
I'll repeat. By X-ray, whenever you see the fundal gas shell on the left side, that is most probably situs solitus. And whenever you see the tracheal shadow, see, as I said, by situs, we are referring to the atrial positions, not the ventricle positions. Ventricle could be any side. If the right atrium is on the right side and the left atrium is on the left side, it is situs solitus. Okay. Now, corresponding to the bronchus, if you see, the right bronchus is broader and is more vertical in line with trachea. Whereas the left bronchus is narrower and more horizontal in compared to trachea. So after seeing the fundal gas shadow, look at the tracheal shadow. The tracheal shadow is, you know, right side bronchus is broader and shorter and left bronchus is horizontal and more horizontal, that is the situs. That's the way you diagnose situs by X-ray. ECG wise, if the P axis is normal, it is situs solitus. If the P axis is rightward, it may point to situs inversus. Okay, that's one question there. And then another question, do large ASD, inlet ASD, VSD, will have similar findings of complete AV canal defect? Yes, because ECG is not telling us the anatomy. ECG is telling that the ECG changes of the underlying large inlet VSD. So ECG wise, you cannot differentiate whether the underlying lesion is a large inlet VSD or a common AV canal defect. You are right. Okay. Now, what is the rate of idioventricular rhythm, junctional rhythm in a newborn baby? See, newborn child has everything on the higher side. Normal heart rate itself can vary between 140 to up to 160 also. Beyond 140, we call it tachycardia, but you can do have. So even in a complete heart block patient, you can have a higher heart rate of say around 60 to 70 in newborn. It's nothing unusual. So I don't know what you mean by idioventricular rhythm. Probably you meant a junctional rhythm. A junctional rhythm, even in the presence of complete heart block in a newborn, can be 60 to 70. Whereas in adults, it will be typically 30 to 40. And many a times, if you see the escape rhythm, it will be a narrow QRS rhythm. Okay. Then how to differentiate antidromic from ED? Okay, this question you can take. Other things are all, I think, rest are all related to tachycardia or arrhythmia. Maybe you both can answer those things. Okay. Thank you. Thank you very much.
Thank you, sir. Roshan, sir, you are there in line?
Yes. I'm here.
You want to take a few questions, sir?
Yeah, I can take the questions. Yeah, sure.
You have a list or can I give you questions?
No, I have the list. I'll start going through them one by one.
Okay, sir. Please.
Whenever you feel the time is excessive, I can stop. So
sure.
There are quite a good number of questions. So it may take some time to go through every one of them. But I'm happy to go through them as per time limits.
Sure, sir. Please.
Yeah. So Dr. Niranjan Joshi has asked whether there's any role for intravenous or oral beta blockers in a stable SVT not responding to adenosine. And he's referring to esmolol in particular and propranolol. Yes, in fact, esmolol is a great drug. And it's a drug we frequently use for pediatric arrhythmias. Esmolol has got a very short half-life. You can start the drug confidently in children where you're worried about hemodynamically stability. And if the BP crashes, you can just stop. And within a few seconds, you're back to what you were before starting the drug. So Esmolol is definitely a great drug. The only downside about Esmolol is that it's expensive. So when you have poor patients, it may be a bit tricky. But otherwise, it's a great drug to use. Then the other question was about from the Muthurama Subramaniam doctor. He's asked about managing WPW with atrial fibrillation. What do you use as IV drug therapy? Now, when you have a patient with pre-excited atrial fibrillation, is what I understand your question is. So you have pre-excited atrial fibrillation means every impulse has got the potential to go down AV node and go down accessory pathway. And of the two guys there, the accessory pathway is the dangerous guy because this refractory period can be short and it can take things really fast. So in such a situation, giving an AV nodal blocker is bad because you're blocking the AV node and you're going to promote further conduction down the accessory pathway. So I think the safest bet in that situation would be to cardiovert the patient. That would probably be the best thing to do in a patient who's got atrial fibrillation with pre-excitation. So pre-excited AF, I would not think it's a wise idea to go down the drug route. The next question was about a refractory by Dr. Manisha. She's asked about refractory infantile atrial flutter in an otherwise stable baby. How do you treat? So when you have atrial flutter, you obviously are wondering what the reason for it could be. And atrial flutter in children is usually due to some other cardiac problem, structural problem. So invariably, when you're talking about atrial flutter, because atrial tachycardia can happen even without structural problem, but atrial flutter is usually related to a structural problem. So either that, so a very good echo is required, first of all, to rule out structural heart disease. And the other setting in which it usually occurs is atrial in children who have actually had cardiac surgery in the past. But de novo having atrial flutter is very, very rare. Now, what we usually do is we, this obviously, because we have the esophageal pacing, you can pace terminate these flutters. And that buys you time while you give drugs and get the drugs to act. Now, you may not necessarily be successful in terminating the atrial flutter with your drug, but you definitely will be able to reduce your ventricular rate with your AV nodal blocking. So you can give beta blockers, start off with IV Esmolol, then change over to a longer acting drug like propranolol. And once you've got adequate AV nodal blockage, then you're going to have your ventricular rates well controlled. And as long as your ventricular rates are controlled, you're unlikely to go into ventricular dysfunction. So, you know, the key there is your flutter is not going to be responding to your drugs is to control the ventricular rate. Then Dr. Santosh has asked whether you can try metoprolol for SVT termination. Yes, you can try metoprolol. IV metoprolol can definitely be tried. In the past, before adenosine was used, we used to use IV metoprolol. So there's nothing wrong with that. Make sure that you have the necessary things. You know, the asthmatic patient, you don't want to sort of precipitate an asthmatic attack. So those kind of things you have to be careful about. Then the next question I have is, how can we, so Dr. Adruti has asked from Delhi, how can you differentiate between atrial flutter with 2:1 and AVNRT? So when you're actually, when you're talking about atrial flutter and AVNRT, so AVNRT invariably has got 1:1 conduction. There's a possibility for AVNRT to have, not have 1:1 conduction as well. But when you're talking about an atrial flutter, you're talking about atrial rates going on regularly at around 300. Whereas in an AVNRT, your atrial rates are going to be much slower. They're going to be around 180 to 200 range. So if you have that typical sawtooth appearance, atrial rate going on at 300, you know it's an atrial flutter. The importance is to look at 12 leads and look at all the 12 leads because you'll pick that up in one or two of those 12 leads. The other thing is to give adenosine and that will nicely block your AV conduction and bring out your P waves and you can see the P waves clearly running through and you know that you've got an atrial flutter going on. Then the other question by Palak Gupta was about orthodromic AVRT. Is it a short RP tachycardia? So that's a good question. The thing is, orthodromic AVRT basically means AVRT, atrioventricular reentrant tachycardia, that is coming down the AV node and going up the accessory pathway. That's all that orthodromic AVRT means. Now, whether your RP is going to be short or RP is going to be long totally depends on how that accessory pathway conducts. if the accessory pathway is going to be taking long time to conduct, then your ventricle will get activated. After a long time, only your atrium is going to get activated. So you will effectively have a long RP tachycardia because your QRS has happened, then the pathway took a long time to take the impulse and carry it to the atrium. So your RP will become long. But if your pathway is a normally, how all pathways normally behave, where they conduct very fast, then your RP is going to be short. So orthodromic AVRT can be long RP, can be short RP. But when you have an orthodromic AVRT with a pathway that takes a long time to conduct, it's typically called a PJRT, which is a paroxysmal junctional reciprocating tachycardia, which I said was a misnomer. People initially were wondering what it was, but it essentially is AVRT with a slowly conducting accessory pathway. Then the other question that was asked is about differentiating antidromic tachycardia from ventricular tachycardia. This is asked by Dr. Muthurama Subramaniam. This is a whole class in itself, and it's sort of hard to cover just like that with one sentence answer. So when you look at broad complex tachycardias, your main three differentials are ventricular tachycardia, SVT with aberrancy, and antidromic tachycardia. Now, if you look at that as a group, the vast majority of broad complex tachycardias are ventricular tachycardia. About 60 to 70% are ventricular tachycardias. The remaining are SVT with aberrancy, about 30 to 35%. So antidromic tachycardia is only about 3% of all broad complex tachycardias. It's pretty rare. So when you're talking about trying to differentiate broad complex tachycardias, you're essentially trying to differentiate SVT with aberrancy from ventricular tachycardia. You're not really trying to differentiate antidromic from these two, because antidromic is so rare, you're not really bothered about it. But it's quite easy. I mean, there are hard and fast rules to differentiate SVT with aberrancy from VT, and that's the primary fact is based on the activation of the ventricle. So when you're talking about ventricular tachycardia, you have a focus in the ventricle that's activating the rest of the ventricle. So the activation is going to take time. Whereas if it's an SVT with aberrancy, the initial QRS activation is going to be rapid, because you have either one of the bundle branches which is working and one of them is not working so well. So your whichever works well, that part of the ventricle is going to get activated fast. So your slope of your QRS, initial slope, is going to be rapid when it's an SVT with aberrancy. Whereas in the VT, it's going to be a sloppy slope. Now, when you're looking at antidromic tachycardia, it's going to be difficult to differentiate antidromic tachycardia from VT, because antidromic tachycardia will also involve activation of ventricles, which can be sloppy because due to activation of a pathway landing in the ventricle. So the short answer is it's difficult to differentiate antidromic tachycardia from ventricular tachycardia. But if you are actually trying to differentiate between these two and you have ruled out SVT with aberrancy, I would say that you treat the patient as VT, because antidromic tachycardia is far too rare. The other thing is that if you've got a broad complex tachycardia and you're having negative in V4, V5, V6, then it's unlikely to be antidromic tachycardia, because antidromic tachycardia means activating the ventricles through the accessory pathway, and the accessory pathways all usually land at the base of the heart. Land around the annulus, which is the base of the heart. So the activation is going to proceed towards the apex, and your V4, V5, V6 are near the apex. So your V4, V5, V6 are going to record positives. So if you're getting negatives V4, V5, V6, the odds are it's VT and not antidromic tachycardia.
Roshan sir, yeah. Lawrence here. So we have a good number of practicing pediatricians here. Yeah. So there are questions about management also. So from my point of view, my drug of choice in most of the pediatric arrhythmias remains adenosine, followed by amiodarone if it is a arrhythmia other than AV nodal reentry or AV reentry, while other drugs like intravenous beta blockers and calcium channel blockers, I think verapamil is not available. Dilsum we don't commonly use in pediatric age group. So followed by a cardio version. So do you want to highlight on your way of managing arrhythmias in your setup, and for advice for our pediatricians also in their setup, what all can they do?
Sure. So essentially, when you have a child presenting to you with an arrhythmia, like Dr. Lawrence said, adenosine would be the go-to drug first. And now if adenosine doesn't work and your tachycardia is still continuing, what I usually do is I start with IV esmolol. Amiodarone is not the drug I would start off straight off next, primarily because amiodarone has got multiple side effects, and the young child, you sort of don't want this child to be taking amiodarone for a long time in life. So I immediately try IV esmolol. IV esmolol usually helps in bringing the ventricular rate down. But now we are talking about acute management of an arrhythmia. So child is in arrhythmia and child is in failure, and you need to get on top of it. And in that kind of situation, when IV esmolol doesn't sort of help, then I would think of IV amiodarone to help as a supplement. So now I don't sort of do too many changes at a time, because that leaves me unsure as to which drug helped and which drug didn't help. So if IV esmolol is on flow and it has not made a difference, I will add on IV amiodarone to it and then watch. And then eventually later on, pull off one of them based on how things go. So I would not stop esmolol and start amiodarone. I'll add amiodarone on top of the esmolol and then take it from there. That's sort of how I go about it. The other thing is, if it's an atrial arrhythmia and I'm kind of sure that's an atrial tachycardia, then obviously I would get flecainide into the picture, because flecainide is a great drug for atrial arrhythmias. And some of these kids, a lot of kids who actually have incessant tachycardias have PJRT, which Dr. Kannan sir spoke about. PJRT is one of those notorious things which presents incessant tachycardias. The other guy responsible for incessant tachycardias in children is usually atrial tachycardia. And when it's a PJRT, it's a reentrant tachycardia. And some of these kids are already in tachycardia for 3 or 4 days before the mother brings the baby, because they took time to recognize that the child actually had the problem. So child has come with severe ventricular dysfunction with this tachycardia going on. And then you sort of need to buy time. And we are fortunate that we can do this esophageal pacing. So we pace, terminate the arrhythmia. And the ICU doctors know to sort of turn on pacing to terminate the arrhythmia every time the arrhythmia starts off. And it takes time for the drug doses to build up in the body and for the drug to really act. And that way you sort of avoid cardioversion. But that's not going to be available everywhere. And so I think your go-to drug would definitely be adenosine first, and then IV esmolol, and then you would decide on flecainide or IV amiodarone based on the situation.
Kannan sir, are you online, sir? Can you unmute?
Yes, yes.
Sir?
Yeah, please.
Sir, do you also follow the same thing, or you have any anything to add on management, sir?
No, sir, practically same. Practically same. Most of the time, the initial management is not difficult, especially only in the post-operative period we do find difficulty. As you said, amiodarone comes to our help, even in junctional reciprocating tachycardia, which you commonly see following ICR and things like that. So, but those children who do not have structural heart disease, who come to OP, most of them are very, very stable hemodynamically. And as you rightly said, 99% of them respond to adenosine. So immediate management is not a major concern. And as Dr. Jonathan is very, and you also have very well said, majority disappears by itself by 1 or 2 years. So long-term management also needed only for a small set of patients, only those who have structural heart disease.
There's just one other thing I just wanted to add to this, and that is that when I presented my thing about AVRT, the vast majority of AVRTs that present in less than 1 year of age, you know, about 40 to 50% of them don't, thereafter they will not have the tachycardia. So, you know, the child has come with tachycardia and it was sort of a failure. So you started drugs. So what we do in our center is you start the child on drugs, keep the child on drugs for a year. And at the end of 1 year, we try do an EP study to induce the tachycardia, because the vast majority of these kids will not have tachycardia after 1 year. So again, we do the EP study through the esophageal route. So we try to induce tachycardia with aggressive stimulation. And when all our program facing protocols have not induced tachycardia, we know that this arrhythmia is not going to happen and we withdraw the drug. So that is something that I find very useful. The other important thing is that we teach all our mothers to auscultate while they are in the hospital. So every mother is asked, the father is asked to go and buy a stethoscope and come. And with the nurse, the mother is taught to auscultate the child and count the heart rate. So then the mother is asked to get a notebook, and the mother periodically monitors heart rate 3 or 4 times a day. So that makes a huge difference. Once they maintain these record books and they come back, we know that the child is not having an arrhythmia as well. So that's another useful thing to do. Because once you train the mother does it. And I have hardly found any mother not able to do it. They all run into trouble when the child is crying, but we are not worried about when the child is crying. When the child is sleeping, you pick up a fast heart rate, you know there's a problem.
Yeah, okay. See, two things regarding this tachycardia in infancy. We do not know. Sometimes it could be rarely be AV NRT, but most of the things are related to bypass track. in older children, adults, we ask them to avoid digoxin. But in pediatric, especially infancy, digoxin also can be used, but we prefer propranolol. But digoxin also can be used, as you have said, up to 1 year. But the recommendation has been we continue up to 2 years and withdraw and watch, rather than subjecting for repeat study. You have the facility to do esophageal tracing and things like that. But otherwise, as we say, 80% have a spontaneous death. In the sense, because these are the residual fibers connecting the atrium and ventricle where the AV groove fibers have not developed. So once the child comes out of the womb and once the child grows, the AV ring becomes more fibrous and the connection between atrium and ventricle goes away. So only those who are remaining subsequently will need a RF ablation maybe beyond 4 years of age. So two things. If somebody is not comfortable with propranolol, they want to use digoxin, they can still use the digoxin as a maintenance of antiarrhythmic drug. And around 2 years of age, they can withdraw and see whether the arrhythmia occurs. The arrhythmia occurs, most probably they are going to be in long-term antiarrhythmic and subsequently RF ablation will be needed. Thank you.
I think that's very practical. That's what we also do. Like most of the time, we keep the kid up to 2 years for medications. We use digoxin also a lot. I think our pediatricians are very fond of using digoxin. And as you told, that's the reason I, after putting a slide on all the drugs, I put a gave a separate slide to digoxin, which we don't do in any of our adult talks. Because adult talks, digoxin is always omitted. So in pediatric talk, I thought that's the reason I put a slide. And digoxin is a very good drug for fetal arrhythmias also, because of the crossing of placental. I think anything else you want to add on Roshan, sir? If that's the case, I think everyone can have our final comments and we can...
the only other thing I wanted to add was about the role for ablation, which you covered well. It's important for all the physicians and the MBBS practitioners who are listening to this to recognize the fact that for AVNRT, AVRT, and atrial tachycardia, ablation is almost 100% cure. So in this day and age, when you're having a child with recurrent symptoms, and the child is more than 5 years of age, then it's important to sort of send this patient to a facility where they're happy to take on the child and plan an ablation procedure. Because the child doesn't have to take beta blockers or calcium channel blockers all his or her life. And the child will be totally cured and fine and, you know, like nothing has happened. So... that's something which I think has still not sort of percolated through to the vast majority. The people who are knowledgeable, of course, know about this, but the vast majority of people across the country are still not sort of into that, referring the child for an ablation when the child comes with recurrent symptoms and is on medications for a long time.
Thank you, sir. Karan, sir, your final comment, sir?
Yeah, same. There is nothing more to add, but as I said, the importance of using ECG for the structural heart disease is slightly limited, but whatever the best we can use, I have kind of told, as you said, it maybe it's going to be there in the YouTube. One can go through and apply it properly. Thank you. Thank you very much.
Thank you, sir. I sincerely thank both of you for spending your, I think we had around close to 3.5 hours. Good to have you all on Sunday morning for this wonderful discussion. We had wonderful questions and I think our participation has close to 1,300 people. That's great on a Sunday morning. I sincerely thank IPCA for organizing this wonderful webinar and we'll hope to have further of these in future also. Thank you, sir. Thank you very much.
Thank you.